Hello, everybody. Welcome. It is Coffee with Curmudgeons. It's on Friday, and we're running a little late, a little behind, and that's my fault. That is my fault entirely. I've been getting over some stuff. I had kind of a thing going on and whatnot, but we've got so much for you, believe it or not. By the way, I'm here with... my co-host, and that would be the thing that was formerly the arm. I totally messed that up.
It's all good.
It was late. This is Jason Allen.
Hello everybody, folks. We have got a scoop, an exclusive. Listen, CNN, Fox News, MSNBC, anyone else you want to, you know, put in line. They got nothing on us this morning.
No.
Nothing.
No,
all right,
scoop.
People were out there. There were minions in the streets. Word on the street was there's an exclusive going on. You need to check this out. So I get a phone call late last night, like what 1 and 2 in the morning. And it's Doc. Yeah. Doc says, hey, you need to get to the parking garage on 5th and Elm right now in the
third
sub-level because we got some shady dealings going on. I said, what's going on? I said, an exclusive. And so we met a guy in a trench coat with a big pork pie hat on. And we said, hey, you know, we feel like this is like real Washington Post type stuff. We need a nickname from you because we just can't call you, you know, Mr. Bob or Herv, you know, Herv Velichez or whatever. We need something spicy. And he looks at us. Yeah, he looks at us and he pauses for a moment. The red glow of his cigarette in the darkness, you know, he's thinking about it. And he looks at us and he says, call me Earl. So I said, Earl,
oh, wow.
Earl, all right. So, and I said, what about Deep Throat? Because, you know, it's like Watergate stuff, right? And he says, no. I was okay. So Earl, I know you're out there watching Earl.
That's right. So. Oh, yes. Man. Well, no, it was, look at that. I'm trying to adjust the cameras. See, I'm sorry. I was late. Well, first of all.
Yeah.
We were up late.
Well, yeah.
America was up late last night.
Watching the Senate floor.
Watching C-SPAN. You know, when C-SPAN is your must-see TV.
Right. This was like the Super Bowl for C-SPAN, right? They're like, oh my gosh, it's midnight. But look at the ratings, man.
Yeah. Yeah. And so the reason we were up in America late last night was why? Because of a healthcare vote.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So here's the deal. Here's where I stand on that.
Yes.
And the whole thing with the healthcare is that the Democrats like Schumer, you know, they're like, well, we know Obamacare is not quite right and blah blah blah. Yeah, it isn't. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
It's not perfect.
But no, far from it. Right. I think. But and Americans want that fixed.
Right.
But here's the dealio. Okay, Mitch McConnell. When you go out to go repeal it,
yeah,
to go fix it, and don't have anything in place, a plan in place to, you know,
yeah,
to replace it.
God, good Lord. They've been talking about this like for 7 years.
7 years you had.
You, no one ever thought when they're sitting around God, their little country clubs, you know, the white-only country clubs, smoking their stogies, like, geez, maybe we better have some
So the story substance. I read, and it was like 8 pages, right?
Yeah.
And the story I read, they knocked this out at lunch. Over, it's like seven over a salad. Years, you know? Yeah. No, it was probably over steak and whatever.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah.
Senators eat. You eat bugs, we eat steak.
They probably carve the cow live right in front of them just for the sacrifice. Well, no, I mean, you know, I don't know what goes
you
on
mean
in
like
these.
Like Apocalypse Now, like style.
Yeah. Like, I don't know what's going on in these white only country clubs.
Man.
You know?
I'm still getting over this. Speaking of healthcare.
I know.
I've had a whole thing this week, just kind of like, you know, the little summer flu kind of thing. I was like, oh. Anyway, but anyway, yeah. The healthcare vote. And yeah. So there it was, and you know, and so it was McCain and all that stuff, you know.
Right.
I don't know. I don't know what to say about McCain. I really don't know what to say about McCain, that guy.
I can tell you're conflicted about McCain.
Yeah. Yeah, he's something else. Well, so the question is, he you didn't catch it the first time, but they got it the second time, and I watched it. He walks up, puts his hand out,
yeah,
McCain hand, and they ask him his vote, and he goes,
and right,
points down
like he's up in the Coliseum giving a thumbs down to the you know.
So that was interesting.
Yeah.
So the question is, see, I'm not as nice about this.
Mm.
So I think the big thing is people are like, you know, he's got a lot of things going on in his personal life, right?
Sure.
Okay. And so then there's a legacy and all of that. And sure. So they're spinning it. They're saying, you know, he's voting. He doesn't care.
Yeah, nothing left to lose, and he's
exactly.
And he's
he wants to. He doesn't want to go down as, you know,
a stooge.
Yeah. Right. So that's what they're saying. Of course, I'm always like, you know what, what big pharma, insurance company, whatever, is in someone's pocket that made this go down? Because, no offense, folks, but that's how it works in Washington.
I'm sure the lobbyists and the phone calls last night mm-hmm. was at a fever pitch.
Now, I mean, Collins has always kind of been an indie from Maine.
Yeah.
Republican senator from Maine. So that was pretty much a done deal. We knew she was going to not vote for it.
And, well, we also had a pretty good idea about Murkowski, too.
Or Murkowski from Alaska.
And the you know, right. the Alaskan delegation has always been kind of a we'll do our own thing, you know.
Yeah.
We expected those two. We just didn't know who else was going to come out of the woodwork.
Right.
And it did, but it didn't surprise me about McCain, because now when you see it in totality and you look back in retro,
right.
You can see now some of the context on that speech he gave on the floor about, you know, you can almost say, okay, he had this along. That's what his mind was. But you never know.
I don't know. It's all so weird.
Yep.
I mean, but again, I think that, you know, I think there is a good segment of Americans who want Obamacare fixed, and it's the skyrocket and all that stuff.
Yeah.
But they didn't have a plan.
No, you know? No.
It's like when you go to fix something, bring your plan to fix it.
Right. Well, you see,
typical Washington.
Right.
Typical GOP.
Yeah. But it's kind of a ruse, too, right? Because in the years after Obamacare, it was kind of like a frame they put up there, and they're going to, like, tinker with it as time goes by, right, to make it better. But the problem was, is when they did that, like, especially after the midterms after that, when the Republicans got their huge advantage both in the House and now in the Senate, their whole thing was, no, we're not going to deal on anything. And this has been their whole plan all along. They're going to keep it status quo, knowing that as more time went by, the plan would become more of a shell. And so they can claim, see, it's faller. It, you know, it sucks. We need to get rid of it. But on the other hand, it was meant as a first step in an ongoing tinkering process to make, you know, to make the Affordable Care Act better. It's just that the GOP never wanted any part of that. And so they now stand back 7 years later and say, oh, yeah, see, we told you it was an, it's a nightmare, you know, right. Or it's like rarely seen before. And it just... So that doesn't hold water with me, and this whole we're just going to stand back and watch it implode sort of motif that, you know, Trump has been thrown out there. Plus, even McConnell's kind of echoed him. It just it almost at this point seems just to the people who are on the ACA and depend upon that health care and those services, it seems just to me it's always seemed very cruel to use it as some sort of political leverage. You know,
that's right. I mean, so, it's yeah.
I'm conflicted about it.
That was my thing. It was like, you know, there's folks I know and I've seen have posted and said, if we wouldn't have this, I wouldn't have health care. Yeah. I wouldn't have coverage for my kid who's sick or whatever.
Yeah, the pre-existing cancer. They, you know, no insurance would have touched me unless, yeah. You know.
So. But we live in a sick and violent society.
We do. Happy Friday, everybody.
Fight me on it. Come on.
That's right. Challenge them. Challenge them. This could be like West Side Story with the Sharks and the Jets. Yeah. Challenge them.
No, we need to. I mean, it's like McConnell is such a blowhard. Oh, man, I can't stand that guy.
Yeah.
You know what? Here's the thing. Throw them all out. Start over.
Right.
See, I'm one of those. I'm one of those guys, you know.
Yeah, but that's like the mooch. You know, it's like, get them all out of there. We're going to.
Well, yeah. I was just going to say, I was looking because, you know, everyone was waiting after the vote.
Yeah.
And this was like, what, 2 a.m. last night, East Coast? It was like 11 something.
It was like 2:11 when the vote went down.
It seemed like 2 a.m. here on the West Coast. Right. Believe me. I was like, what time is it? And, of course, then it was like I don't know, it was like 20 minutes later or whatever, we had 3 Republicans and 48 Democrats let the American people down. As I said from the beginning, let Obamacare implode, then deal. Watch.
Jeez. What a piece of work.
Man, that's your president.
Right.
And then 3 hours ago, he said, if Republicans are going to pass great future legislation in the Senate, they must immediately go to a 51-vote majority, not senseless 60.
Oh, boy.
Even from the guy who knows so much about legislation.
Right. Yeah.
Even though parts of the health care could pass at 51, some really good things need 60. So many great future bills and budgets need 60 votes. So he just, 3 hours ago, he says a thing about not senseless 60. And then he follows up with, even though parts of health care could pass at 51. Yeah. Some really good things need 60. So many great future bills and budgets need 60 votes. You know, that's a Twitter account where someone grabs the phone an hour later and goes, I need to respond on Twitter.
We got to mop this up.
God.
You know there's like some aide, and his name probably is Jenkins.
Yeah.
He or she. They're sitting in their tiny cubicles, shunted off into the corner, and their sole job, folks, their sole job is to watch the Twitter feed, you know, and I wonder if they got like a whole code, like, you know, Eagles on Twitter. And so they're, you know, they're getting up there, and, oh crap, he said this, I gotta go clean this up. Then they get on there and just kind of, you know, and say the exact opposite 25 minutes later.
Yeah, it just, yeah. Yeah, I mean, it was like 3 hours and 2 hours ago. Look at the Twitter.
Yeah.
It's like the opposite. That's the president of the United States. Are you kidding me?
This
is like
your
America.
American life.
Look, yeah. I gave these, you know, I give everyone a chance.
Yeah.
But then you're done.
That's right. That's right.
Telling you, it's so, and we had so much going on. Yeah. We're Monday, Friday now.
Yeah,
turning left. Was it Monday?
Mm-hmm.
As we were doing the show, Sean Spicer resigned.
Right? Yes. Uh huh. Yep. He resigned Monday. I think it was like 35 minutes into our broadcast.
Yeah.
We had the boom. He's out.
So we had that.
And we got hit with the mooch.
Scaramucci, and then we've been talking about the Boy Scouts.
Yeah.
And Trump did the thing at the Boy Scouts, and that was just ridiculous.
Oh, it was horrible.
And you said, like, yesterday, I mean, there was a statement and then another statement that came out.
Yeah.
And I saw it, too, from the Boy Scouts of America that basically was like...
apologizing for the president.
Yeah, yeah. You know? Because he came out there and what's weird is we've been talking about this Boy Scouts, and we've even talked about the Jamboree. I had no idea.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I'm...
Allergies. God, I miss here.
But anyway, now I'm just getting over this thing. It's just I just got hit by this thing. So so anyway, he goes out there and he gives just the most bizarre speech to these kids. At one point in the speech, he talks about his friend who retired and was jet setting around the world, having a lifestyle. Yeah. I mean, you're telling 13-year-old the Boy Scouts this. Oh, good, Mr. You know?
Yeah.
Anyway. And then he talks about momentum. I mean, it's kind of, you know what it is? Mm. It's kind of Alec Baldwin's specifically written scene for the film adaptation of Glengarry Glen Ross.
Oh, God.
You know what it takes to be a Boy Scout? Brass balls.
That's right.
It's like, what are you doing? And I said that when I was a Boy Scout and did all these things, we had...
Eagle Scout, right?
There you go.
There you go.
I know, everyone's like, throw it away, son of a... Anyway. there were some things about them, the kids booing when Hillary Clinton and all that, and... I don't know. Bad form, but at the same time, it's like, you know, this is just a bunch of scouts that are there. And the other thing is, how could you let the president come and address the Boy Scouts?
Yeah.
Easy. He's the president. He's invited.
Right.
He's the honorary head of the Boy Scouts. That's how they do it.
Yeah.
You just don't expect it to be that.
And it's tradition, too. I mean, right. this has a long-standing protocol that you have.
Yeah. And we were going to look up and research and see who showed up and what. I can't remember. At the time, it was Reagan, and he didn't show up and give a speech. And we were talking off air.
Yeah.
And I had said, he flew over, like, in a helicopter. Mm-hmm. And there was some press photo of it. Well, he had just gone through the assassination attempt.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And he just recovered, or was recovering.
And he was still recovering from that, yeah.
Yeah, and so he didn't show up on stage.
But at least he made the effort to do a flyover and let him know that he was there and thinking about him. That's
but
cool.
here's the weird realization I had. And had the assassination attempt not happened,
mm-hmm.
Reagan being Reagan.
Yeah.
I think would have shown up.
Well, sure.
And given a speech.
Probably would have given one heck of a speech.
Peggy Noonan was his speechwriter?
Yeah.
I mean, responsible.
William Sapphire and Peggy Noonan.
Yeah, responsible for a lot of his great quotes and all that stuff. I mean, if there's one thing, look, I was no Reagan fan.
No.
But if there's one thing you can say about Ronald Reagan is he was a quotable president.
Yeah.
I mean, to this day, to this day, I'll never forget Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
That's right, yeah.
I mean, very short and simple, but that echoed.
Or the whole Morning in America speech.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
I mean, this is how he got to be president. He was an actor.
Yeah.
He could deliver his lines.
Yeah.
And I was telling you on Wednesday off the air, I said, you know, if all things being equal, if Reagan would have... You know, presumably been healthy or security or whatever. And again, it had a lot to do with the assassination. I mean, he almost died.
Yeah.
As we know now. But had he shown up and delivered a speech to the Boy Scouts, which I think he would have had that not happened.
Yeah.
It probably would have gone down.
Oh, yeah.
Historically. Like today, we would have been comparing Trump's speech.
Yeah.
What he said to the Boy Scouts. To Reagan's.
Right.
And I was like, well, remember that time Reagan delivered the National Jamboree speech? Remember those lines about freedom and truth and, you know, country? You know, he would have done one of those, right?
And Reagan would have delivered a warm, grandfatherly present speech.
Yeah.
And it would have gone down as, see that? I mean, that's the leader of the Boy Scouts right there. That's the guy.
Well.
Yeah.
As I look out at these 40,000 young men, You are the future of our country. Look, I'm making up the presidential.
And it sounds realistic.
Alternative. Right. Alternative. As we look down the throes of communism to the people who are in shackles and not free. You know, I mean, it would be something like that. Look at that. Look at me. I'm making, first of all, I'm an apologist for Reagan now.
Yeah.
Oh, whoever saw that coming. And I'm making up a fake speech that he never gave to the National Jamboree.
And he's like,
that would have been compared.
Right. And I say to you, you know, scouts, tear down your tents.
Yeah.
You know, and they're like, wow, that's great. This is awesome. It makes me want to make s'mores.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, let's get to the campfire and make some s'mores.
Right.
God bless America.
Scouts, when you're out there walking someone across the street, think of the Gipper. Think of me.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, wow.
No, but had he delivered that speech, I literally popped in my head. I said, we would be watching side by side. CNN and stuff would be like, remember when Reagan gave one of his most historic speeches to the 40,000 gathering of Boy Scouts? Yeah. I mean, it doesn't get any more patriotic than that. That was a made for Reagan moment, right?
Right.
And now we got this.
And now we got this.
He started it. Yeah. He started that speech with, I don't know politics. I don't want to.
You know, there's a show that we could, there's a show on NBC, right, that would be great for this sort of motif.
What, The Apprentice?
No, This Is Us.
Oh, God.
Yeah, folks. This Is Us. Yeah.
Anyway, he's giving a speech right now.
Yeah.
I mean, he's given, and I don't know. I mean, some of the speeches like economics and stuff. Here's the thing. People dig that.
Okay? Yeah. Yeah. But he can't stay on message because he's so out there. Mm. I mean, they'll prepare him a whole speech and like halfway through, he'll just ditch the speech and go improv on him. And that's why the speechwriters for Trump have such a high suicide rate.
Oh, that's right. Actually, just to let you know what is going on, it's live on his Twitter feed right now.
Oh, boy.
he's in Long Island.
That's right.
Today, Long Island, I think. Jeff? Oh, do we know if Jeff Sessions showed up for that?
No, they haven't been in the same room together now in over a week.
Well, but he's Attorney General, so the deal is...
That's right.
This is one of the things that he's working on here, the MS-13.
That's right. Breaking the gangs.
If you don't know what the MS-13 is, it's a gang, I would say more a syndicate. It is actually really...
Almost, scary. Yeah, syndicate slash cartel at this point.
Are they Mexico?
They are. They're Latino and...
And it's a drug gang, think mafia. Drug, heavy duty. Think
Scarface, except they're not Cuban.
Scarface and Miami Vice and all that stuff. They're highly violent.
Very heavy violent.
Highly violent. So, like, you know, if you get mixed up with these MS-13 folks,
not gonna end well.
It's kind of like your family's literally dead. You know, that sort of thing.
It's like Capone. And I want you dead. I want your family's dead. Yeah. I want to come back at midnight. And,
So anyway. It's a bad gang drug thing, and so Trump's. And it's about, they've had a lot of crimes in New York.
Yeah.
MS-13. And it's...
L.A. too, huge.
And it's the whole, the thing is it kind of plays into Trump's whole border wall stuff and everything. This is one of the, examples, because, you know, it's immigration and all sorts of stuff.
Mm-hmm. The war on drugs. People,
yeah.
Yeah.
Which, I don't know. I mean, you can track those people and...
Yeah.
Get them out. I don't know. So anyway, so they're doing some big push for the MS-13.
There's a rival thing, and I wonder how this is going to go down. There's a lot of LGBTQ.
Oh my gosh!
They were going to show up at a speech for a counter protest. And
really at the MS-13?
Yeah, another thing late at night
Oh, by the way, I want to say as I understand it,
mm-hmm.
Just to be clear, folks, it's transgender people, not other connotations of that. But anyway, we had the ban, midnight, you know, or in the middle of the night, a tweet, a ban, no transgender military folks.
Yeah, even though there's like 7,000 of them serving literally right at this moment.
You know, here's the deal.
Yeah.
The military is huge. Okay?
Huge.
And it's not just everyone carrying guns either. I mean, it's people carrying guns. It's people. There's a lot of infrastructure. Yeah. I mean, it's a huge organization, and as such, and being a huge organization, the military has been an institution that has been forward leading.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was the first institution that. Became integrated.
Yeah.
For example.
Yeah.
And so this thing to the military, you know, my gosh, I watched this whole crap show, Sarah Huckabee Sanders, and they said, well, the president said this late at night. We went to the Pentagon and asked the generals, because who asked for this? The generals. And they said, oh, we don't know. Go ask the White House.
Right.
And so they come back to the White House. And they go ask the Pentagon.
Right.
Oh, so smart.
Yeah,
so
wonderful. And then they said, where does Mattis come down on all this as Secretary of Defense? And when they went looking for Mattis, oh, that's right. Trump launches this when Mattis is on vacation and has literally no idea that this was going to be even, you know.
Well, it was just, I'm sorry about the politics stuff, but I mean, it's been like a 24/7 cycle. But yeah. I mean, it's so I've
the last 72 hours has
I've
been.
Known
yeah
in the past I have known people who have served who were transgender persons.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like, wow, you know, and it's like it's you're making a problem where there isn't one. And so here's, as I will paraphrase, the problem where the president thinks there's a problem is he doesn't want to pay for the health care.
Huh.
Okay?
Yeah.
For being transgender person.
Yeah.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
In the military. There's this famous report that popped up. You can Google it, by the RAND Corporation.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Very well-known liberal left-wing communist organization, the RAND Corporation. No, they're military contractor. They do stuff for military in the deep state. And the whole report.
It's safe to say they're not left-leaning.
Yeah, and the whole report is, you know, this is a non-issue. This is how it's addressed. And
yeah, they threw out the one tasty fact was that the military spends more money on Viagra than it does with medical costs for transgendered military personnel.
Yeah. People, yes. Yeah. Yes, yes. So that's crazy. And as of yesterday, they were asking, you know, the top brass, the military.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so how is this going to be implemented? Well, the thing that Sarah Huckabee Sanders yesterday had to sit there, and reporters were like, what about those people that are serving in the military right now?
Yeah. What are you going to do with the 7,000 active service?
Right.
And
no answer. No answer.
There was worse than no answer. She got so fed up that she literally threatened to close down the press conference if one more question about it.
No, she kept saying, I answered it already.
Yeah.
Which means I have no answer. I mean, hard for me to say poor lady, I mean, it's like, who wants that job?
Spicy's like, hey, your job now.
Exactly. Spicy's like, in the bushes, just hanging out. Yeah. They're saying that he might be on Dancing with the Stars.
No.
Yeah.
Oh, geez,
they reached out to him.
Well, I want to see him do the foxtrot. Yeah.
Yeah, Spicy on Dancing with the Stars.
As you can tell.
And then they're saying, oh, God, if they could get Spicy and Melissa McCarthy on the same show.
Ooh.
Brilliant.
Ooh, she dresses up as Spicy.
So I don't know.
It's like them two dancing together, and it's like, it's a mirror image.
Mm-hmm.
This could work.
Spicy. Anyway,
wow! You blew my mind with that.
That's what they're saying.
Wow,
that's what the sources say.
Word on the street.
So there, we had that.
Yeah.
And so that was just a crap show, as we like to say here.
Yeah, yeah.
You can put in your other word. But again. And so this thing was just a tweet late at night from the president about this policy, military policy. And so I've read that the speculation is that he made this decision because of a horse trade. Yes. In the Congress?
Yes.
Uh-huh. You heard this one?
Yes. There were some members of Congress, especially the real real far right. They wanted this. They've been yammering about this for years, and they offered it up as leverage to help smooth some feathers that they would advocate for. And so evidently they went to the White House like literally the day before Trump did this. And was telling him, you know, if you do this, we will do this. And I think Trump, with his impulse control problems, just kind of...
Yeah, it was...
mind-vomited.
It had something to do with a budget.
Yes.
Like if...
The debt ceiling, I believe.
If he did this... Yeah. And yeah, it was probably to appease the real right-winger...
Yeah. The Freedom Coalition or whatever they are.
Yeah, those folks who are Bible Belt... kind of folks, whatever.
Yeah.
Down there with their thumping on the Bible and all that stuff.
Very, very Falwellian. Yeah. Right? Falwellian.
Yeah. So here's the deal. Falwellian. Here's what I'm going to say.
Okay.
Uncle Doc Normal.
Ooh, Uncle Doc.
You're okay. You're
if
dealing,
you're Haitian, you could be Papa Doc.
Yeah, no.
Sorry.
It's funny, though. Kind of. Clinton Foundation.
For the one person out there that got it right.
Yeah.
Oh.
This is a show.
Yeah. And a good one. And a good one, too.
Yes. And there are two guys here. Okay?
Doc at Norman, the moment, sure.
Jason. And I don't want to speak for you.
Okay. Oh, you can go ahead.
I'm going to speak for myself. And, you know, you're dealing with two folks, at least. You know, from my perspective, white male, what you would call cisgendered.
Okay.
Which means I am a male. I am comfortable being a male.
Yep.
And that's that. Okay. I'm comfortable with myself. Right. And this thing.
Yeah.
People who are transgender. Persons?
Sure.
First of all, persons, people, key.
Yeah.
You have no... I have... All you can do is be an ally, and that's it, okay? End of story. Period. You don't know. We don't know what that person goes through.
No, not at all.
And here's the thing. I've read... You know, you get on the internet, and of course this thing happens, and you see the butt hats... I'm trying to clean it up and not...
Those butt heads.
Well, or that, you know...
Yeah.
They're really, really... And, you know, you just see all the bile and the anti-LGBT stuff just come out.
Yeah.
And you're like, you don't even know. You are not living in those shoes.
No, right, yeah.
To use an old analogy.
You haven't walked a mile in their moccasins.
And that's always, you know, my grandma...
Yeah.
That's one thing I grew up with.
Yeah.
You do not pass judgment on someone unless you've walked in their shoes.
Yeah.
That's an old, old one, right?
Right.
And so this isn't like a thing where, you know, the military shouldn't pay, blah, blah, blah. You know, this is not that. This isn't like going into the military and going, well, you should budget for me to have a muscle car.
right.
This is not a luxury.
No.
This isn't. It's not a lifestyle. It's not. It's
identity. It's just.
Yes.
You know.
Yes. And just deal with it. But I guess if you walk around with a little black book all day and read, you know, stories where someone begat someone and someone else begat someone else.
There's a whole lot of begotten going on.
And sacrifice this for that, the other thing, and burning bushes burn and talk to you and all that stuff. I guess maybe you'd have that perspective.
Well, Old Testament-wise, you would. But it's funny.
And I'm not denigrating Christians, but come on.
But it's funny how those
get your crap together.
You know, the Falwells and
Anyway.
The real far, far, far right. It's funny how whenever they start quoting that stuff, scripture, you know, it's always Old Testament. It's never New Testament, which kind of says, I don't know, the exact opposite.
Yeah, yeah. Love thy neighbor.
Right.
Love thy neighbor.
Yep.
That doesn't mean just your next door neighbor.
No.
You know, you know.
Although my next door neighbor is pretty cool. I will say that.
Good for you.
Yeah. Moving on.
Anyway, love thy neighbor, and there was a real good one, and I the next thing, we've got a joke book, we've got an American flag, we'll have a Bible in here too.
Ooh.
Trust me, it exists.
This could be a hoedown.
But there's that thing, you know, one of my other favorite ones where dude comes out and he says, you know what? The judgment is God. God gets to do the judgment, not
right.
you,
right? Yeah.
Plebes down here on Earth. It's like, there you go.
You proles. You don't get to do that.
I like that one too.
Zex.
Yeah. But anyway, I can't say, I'm not good at saying that, but I'm trying to explain that this is just an issue out of our hands, and it's the president. This is ignorant, okay? And just stop. And the people in the military.
Yeah.
If there's one thing you know, it's like the boot camp scene from Full Metal Jacket.
Mm.
Great film by Stanley Kubrick.
R. Lee Ermey.
And there's all sorts of vile stuff that comes out of that guy's mouth, but it's meant to be a darkly humorous. But the thing you learn, and the thing if you've ever talked to someone in the military, in a Marine, for example, is that once you join that, you are a Marine.
Yeah,
you are a Marine, and then you are everything else you are in your life.
Right,
whether it be gay or whatever, but you are a Marine.
Right,
you are a part of that fraternity, and that's kind of how the military works.
It is.
You know, and you come from all walks of life, and there it is. So this is just, I don't know, what's your prediction? Is this going to fly, or is this going to kind of die on the vine or whatever?
Well,
because the Pentagon's not down with this.
No.
They didn't even know.
No. Well, Joint Chiefs, the statement was, we're not going to follow this. We're not going to follow a tweet. We need some clarification on this.
Yes. Yeah, that was actually the answer. And here's the thing. You know, I know that we have military leaders and stuff, and you have that image of like World War II, you know, kind of a Patton type image of our military leaders. And it's a Hollywood image. Even Patton wasn't, you know. When you're a general, you're a CEO, you know, when you're in the Pentagon. You know, you're not walking around blood and guts. No, you're actually an administrator of a very large bureaucracy.
Right.
You've gone to, you know, had a lot of education.
You're more Eisenhower than you are Patton.
Yeah. And so the folks at the Pentagon who are the Eisenhower administrators are just like, you know. And another thing, big successful corporations, Apple, Microsoft, others. There's two Amazon. Tech companies, Amazon. They deal with this stuff all the time, and again, non-issue. It's like, and so the government is behind the ball. I don't know. It's crazy. Speaking of which, the other issue that came out that has kind of been swept under the carpet, especially with the healthcare, was good old our favorite person in the administration, Jeff Sessions.
Oh, you mean the Jefferson Beauregard Sessions?
Should never be Attorney General. His Justice Department filed a Title IX brief? Title IX. That's the one that gives you rights in institutions, like in education and all that, protects your rights. And so they filed a brief to say that it doesn't cover gay people.
Yeah.
So along with this Pentagon thing, we've got that going on too.
Yeah, it's just
insert same argument here.
It seems like when I saw that I saw the news of the filing, I literally said to myself, man, it's like we've taken a step back 40 years.
Yeah. Well, it's just it's just, you know, here we think we're moving into modernity, and instead we're
one step forward, two back steps at Selma back.
Or something. I don't know. I just whatever. I mean, just stop.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, I'm a social liberal. I have no. I don't know. Just stop. Yeah. Everyone gets along.
No, but about the reaction with the military and what ultimately is going to go on. I think that at the end of the day, soldiers take orders.
Yes,
you take orders from the commander in chief. And but I think this. I don't think we even have to worry about it because the lawsuits are going to be thrown, and it's just aimless verbal vomit rhetoric.
And
of course,
there were people who came out and went on the news and I mean, Navy SEALs.
Sure. That's why don't you meet
you know what the military likes? An efficient soldier.
Yeah.
Period. Doesn't matter. Anything else doesn't matter.
That's exactly right.
We want an efficient soldier.
Yep.
Takes the oath, the military, and do your job.
That's right.
Take orders. And
the creed among soldiers is not only a vocation, it's a brother and sisterhood.
You
look out after your own. And
it's just in our lifetime, that women got to serve, in combat roles.
Sure. Yes.
Just in, what's that? Is that next?
Last 15
is that
years.
Next?
That's next. Yeah.
Is that next? Mm-hmm. And we're going to get a midnight tweet?
Yeah.
I don't think women should be on the battlefield.
Right. And then you watch, it's going to go back to African Americans only doing support roles.
Oh, jeez. Oh, man.
Yeah. Well, I don't know these birds.
Sessions.
You never know. See, that's the funny thing about these guys. They've kept it under a rock now for 25 years, and now all this stuff is coming out.
The best, one thing I did say, the Twitter account for the CDN, which is the Canadian Defense... CDN, CND, I can't remember. It's the national Canadian, the official Twitter account for the National
Defense
of Canada.
Yeah.
Yeah. They were like, we welcome all people.
Right.
It's like, Anyway.
Anyway.
My personal opinion is, I'm kind of anti-military industrial complex, but not anti- military personnel. It's just I don't know, because then we could get into the VA and how the VA treats
that's a whole ball of wax.
Anyway, this is just BS. I didn't know what $9 million out of an unaudited multi-trillion dollar budget. Are you kidding me?
Right.
Are you kidding me? That's like a
It's just, it's just...
Let's see the audit. Jason, do you have the audit? Can we look
Sent for it. It should be flown in here any minute. We sent one of our interns off.
Because every, big institution is audited, right?
Always. It's just one long audit.
Military?
Yeah, we can see it. We'll figure it out, sure.
Can we get it?
Yeah, we can do it.
Are you sure?
Well, after the exclusive that got launched on us late last night, I think those people can find anything.
Well, you'll be looking for a long time for that audit, Jason.
I'm not holding my breath,
The $1 trillion budget hasn't been audited in years.
Yep.
Because they don't know where the money went.
Well, in the budget, everything is redacted, so it's all just one long... It's just one long,
For stuff. That's pretty much what it is. Stuff.
Oh, sweet.
$1 trillion.
What sort of stuff? Military stuff.
I guess you could deduct... The USS Gerald R. Ford.
Sure.
Big, super giant, huge carrier.
Yep.
Can't remember how many. The thing is, I can't remember how much that thing was.
Huge. It's a super carrier.
It's under a billion, isn't it?
I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. It's you don't make a super carrier for on the cheap.
No.
So you can deduct that.
Sure.
And the F-35 and the... And then the overrun of the F-35, and then the reappropriation of the F-35,
and the food budget, the mess hall stuff, you could.
I don't think we know.
You could itemize like pancake batter and stuff.
Maybe I don't know.
I don't know.
Anyway, we're bitchy.
But it's a feel-good Friday.
I know. So there was all that yeah. that happened. No, I didn't mean to talk about politics, but boy, there's just been so much going on.
Yeah.
And it's just so wonderful. And then we had last night with the healthcare thing.
Yeah.
And so then Spicer resigned on Monday when we were doing the show. And yeah. now we got this guy.
This guy.
Who's the new communications director.
This guy.
And yeah. this guy. You thought Spicy was entertaining.
Oh, man.
This guy. So I read last night.
Yeah.
The New Yorker magazine.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
This guy. Guy. Scaramucci. Guy. The Mooch.
This Gambone.
He calls up.
Yeah.
A buddy or something. I don't know. He's a reporter for the New Yorker.
Yeah, he's from New York, and yeah. so he's had a long-lasting sort of working relationship with one of the main mm-hmm. reporters and editors from the New Yorker magazine.
Right.
And
Izza or something, is this guy's name?
Yeah.
And so this everyone read this New Yorker, and then it hit the other news outlets too, but it was first published by the reporter. And it basically was this this thing.
Yeah.
The report was essentially, I'm just sitting here,
yeah,
just sitting here, doing nothing.
It's nighttime.
Phone rings.
Yep. And who is it?
Who's on the other end? The Mooch.
You. Here's how he answered too, right? Yeah. Hi. Yo.
Yeah.
It's the Mooch.
Hey.
That's probably when he starts all of his conversations.
Yeah.
Yo. This is the Mooch.
Yeah.
Hey.
Anyway.
Oh, man.
And so the guy's on the phone.
Yeah.
Going, and the thing he said in the article, he goes, the Mooch, this wasn't off the record. This wasn't like, because usually when you call your friend, the reporter.
Yeah.
And you go, hey.
Can we talk? And I want to talk off the record.
I'm talking off the record.
Yeah.
Okay, can I do that? I'm talking off the record. I'm giving you background. I am not going on record with this. And people go, reporter, integrity, that's
sure.
kind of yeah. how they do it. Because if you don't do it, then you publish the thing, and then the person gets mad at you and won't speak to you again. And mm-hmm. reporters need people to speak to them for their stories.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how it goes. Mooch didn't do that. Instead, he just starts talking to him. And and it's just, it's, wow. I'm trying to summarize in my head what I read. Rance Priebus.
Yeah.
He figures in there. The leakers. It's all about the leakers. We're going to find these. We're going to find me and the Mooch and the Trump.
Right.
We're going to find the leakers. We're going to give them a helicopter ride. We're going to
swimming. Me and Mr. T, we're going to get to the bottom of this.
I know. And so he goes, you got to read this thing in the New Yorker. Yeah. It's amazing. It's fully quoted.
Oh, yeah.
He
the Mooch.
He goes, you know, he and Priebus don't get along.
No.
And he says some choice words of Priebus.
Well, Bannon, too.
But we found out some interesting personal information on Steve Bannon himself.
We did.
Who, according to the Mooch...
The Mooch!
Apparently, Jason, I'm going to get your reaction on this.
Yes, okay.
Likes to, as we would call, auto-fellatiate himself. I think I said that right.
Oh, Bannon?
Yes. Mooch, I believe the quote was, and I don't have it in front of me, but it was like, I'm not Steve Bannon. I'm not out sucking my own...
Beep!
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
It doesn't get any better than this, folks. To the New Yorker.
Yeah.
To the thing. And the guy's just like, uh-huh. Oh, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, yeah. Can you restate that for me? I did. Oh, okay. Thanks. Cool.
I'm just quoting that.
Oh.
What?
Yeah.
What a crazy thing. And his defense, well, let's take a little listen to his defense.
Yeah, let's listen to his defense.
So he gets on CNN.
I love yesterday. Yeah, the reporter goes on the next day on CNN to talk about what happened with Scaramucci, and the Mooch calls in.
The Mooch calling in again.
Right. Yeah, hi, you're on CNN. Yo.
Yo.
This is the Mooch. This is the Mooch.
Yeah. So he gets... And the reporter made it very clear.
Yeah.
I didn't call him.
Yeah.
He called me.
Right.
I mean, it's like... This was not a phone call that I initiated. Yeah,
it was a nighttime, and I'm getting ready for bed, and the mooch calls. It
probably, you know, a little cake, like a little wedge cake, yeah. A little tea.
Yes.
You know, maybe a dog, fluffing the pillows.
And there could be biscuits. Tea and biscuits, right?
You know?
Yeah.
Nice quiet time. Maybe a book, a nice book.
The faint smell of chamomile in the
air. Yes, a book next to the bedside. And here's the, hey, it's the mooch. Hey. Gotta talk to you.
Hey, yo, this the mooch.
I'm no Steve Bannon. I'm not like...
I'm not
making my own ding dong. You know what I'm saying?
Bada bing, bada boom.
So
bada.
Anyway, so I
I'll bada play. Mooch.
Communications director Anthony Scaramucci joins us this morning. Anthony Scaramucci, can you hear us?
Yeah. So when I was speaking to you last night, Ryan, I said it was unpatriotic that you weren't telling me who the leakers were. I was on a plane landing in New York. I have to go visit my mom, and so
you may have caught it wrong way.
I was teasing you, and it was sarcastic. It was one Italian to another.
I was just joking.
Trying to get you to say, if you could give me some sense for where they are.
Folks, this goes on for 10 minutes.
When you said you didn't, I totally respect your journalism and your integrity.
Anthony, I don't know. Hold on, Anthony. I just want to make sure.
He just breaks.
Ryan could hear you.
Yeah,
I can.
But just in case, it didn't go out over the air, so he heard what you meant when you were talking to him about being unpatriotic.
This voice is Andrew Cuomo, by the way.
Yeah.
What's going on in your perspective?
I want to reset at zero, but I also want you to know I just spent about 15 minutes on the phone talking with the President of the United States, who has given me his full support and his full blessing. And I'm gonna read you something, Chris, and you bear with me. And the President also told me, if you're nice to me in this segment, he'll let me come back on the show. Is that cool? So why don't you let me talk
for a little bit? I'm not in the doghouse.
And then you can ask me questions. But this is super, super
This
important.
Is a guy calling in to see, and then you can ask me questions. He's like, I'm calling in. I'm going to read a statement, and the statement is the President, you know, I'm 100% behind the mooch. Yeah,
the mooch.
Even though he said all those things in the New Yorker. And then, and then so he says that. He goes on for 10 minutes. I mean, I sped that up. Just watch it. It's like a 30-minute segment, but he's got a solid 10 minutes. He's basically, I give the guy credit.
Yeah.
He's managing that CNN show. They're just like, all right.
No, they're happy to let him manage.
Just let him go.
You know, in that control booth, and then the guy from the New Yorker, they're all thinking the same thing. I mean, literally, they're thinking the same thing right now. They're thinking, oh, God, this is gold. Keep talking, please.
Now, folks.
Yeah.
Here's what has happened. In the 24-hour news cycle, NuzBox, I got to pull this up here. We have our own exclusive.
Huge.
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 We have a huge exclusive. And what happened last night, because folks, they knew we were going to go on today, our show. And because the mooch is he's in the news.
He's in the news.
And he's calling CNN. He's talking to the reporters and all that. Someone, and he's on the leaks.
And
so
we're gonna protect our sources.
He's all about the leaks.
Yeah.
Someone leaked to us from the White House late last night. We got a leak.
Yep.
We have an exclusive video.
Huge, yes.
Exclusive video of a internal meeting in the White House with Anthony Scaramucci. It is eye-opening.
Yeah.
It's how the White House communications team and director works.
Yeah.
This was snuck out, a leak. I'm told it was on videotape.
Yeah.
It may have been snuck out in very uncomfortable places on this, because the mooch is literally strip searching people as they walk out.
Very clandestine. Yes.
I'm hoping it wasn't a VHS tape.
No. I'm hoping it's beta, you know, or the small, tiny. 8mm.
Yeah, little DV. Anyway, so this has been submitted to NuzBox.
Right.
And this is, I'm told.
Yes.
I haven't seen this yet.
Me either, no.
But I'm told that
Huckabee Sanders. Uh-huh.
Yeah, Huckabee Sanders is not in this meeting, maybe, you know, she was
I'm always saying Huckabee Sanders. I'm just going to call her SHS from now on.
Well, she's a Huckabee. But anyway, we have this exclusive. Yes?
Can I give a disclaimer real quick?
Okay.
Public disclaimer, folks. This is going to be shocking.
Yes.
You have not seen this. I have not seen this.
No.
If you have small children You may want them to exit the room because what you are about to see, what I'm told, is what you are about to see is so groundbreaking and so earth-shattering that literally you need to really... You need to get the small children and grandma and everyone out of the room that because this is hot stuff.
I do want to say when it was submitted, our intern actually edited it for content for TV.
Right.
So it's been edited for television.
Sanitized a little bit. Yes. Making sure there's no violations.
Bad of, words, FCC stuff. So this has been edited for television, I am told. Yeah. But this is hidden, exclusive, Jason, hidden camera footage of a lunch meeting, the communication director and his staff. And the person you'll hear talking is Anthony Scaramucci, communication director. Let's take a listen.
What's really funny is the bank job away in Sea Caucus, I'm in the middle of the weeds laying down. He comes over, he says, what are you doing? I said, I'm resting. Here, you're resting.
That's
the beach in the park. I said, I'm resting. I know I'm resting. I'm resting. They pull me in. They start giving me all kinds of questions, you know, this and that. He says, oh, so what are you going to tell us, tough guy? I said, my usual, zero, nothing. I tell you, the He says, oh, you're going to tell me something today, tough guy. I said, all right, I'll tell you something. Your mother.
This is just amazing.
Huge.
You saw the paper, Anthony. My head was up like this.
Look how nervous the staffers are.
Around, you know, I start to come out of it. Who do I see in front of me? This big again. He says, oh, what do you want to tell me now, tough guy? I said, Bing, what are you doing here? I thought I'd tell you to your mother. I thought he was going to Oh, Bing.
Wow.
I wish I was big just once.
Yeah.
Really funny. Really funny.
What do you mean, I'm funny?
It's funny, you know. It's a good story. It's funny. You're a funny guy.
What do you mean? You mean the way I talk? What?
It's just, you know, you're just funny. It's
how he's
you can feel the tension.
Yeah, the way really. Everything.
Funny how? I mean, what's funny about it?
The Scaramucci guy. No, he's got
He's a big boy. He knows what he said. What'd you say? Right. Funny how?
You know, you're funny.
You mean, so? Let me understand this, because you know, maybe it's me, I'm a little maybe. But I'm funny how? I mean, funny like I'm a clown, I amuse you. I make you laugh, I'm here to amuse you. What do you mean funny? Funny how? How am I funny?
No, just, you know how you tell a story, what?
No, I don't know, you said it. How do I know? You said I'm funny. How the f*** am I funny? What the f*** is so funny about me? Tell me what's funny.
I think he actually used that in the CNN interview.
Mm.
Get out of here, Tommy.
I almost had him.
Well, there it is.
Wow.
Jason.
Wow.
Exclusive.
Wow.
NuzBox.
Wow.
That was a communications director, the Mooch. Lunch meeting with his staff.
Incredible.
Threatening his staff. So
incredible.
Yeah, I don't know what to say.
I'm speechless.
Yeah.
Wow.
And then we had a follow-up, believe it or not.
Yeah?
With all this exclusive.
Yeah.
So I don't know where this came from.
Yeah.
But someone else submitted a secret tape. Apparently, this is some surveillance camera footage from when Scaramucci was in high school.
High school? Wow, high school. They're digging deep on this. Okay.
Yeah. You know, he's Brooklyn... New York kind of a guy, as he pointed out. So we got a surveillance footage of a meeting he was having with his teacher.
Interesting.
Yeah, so we'll take a little look at that.
Okay.
Mr. Carter?
This is James Buchanan High School in Brooklyn, New York, around 1979. That's Anthony Scaramucci there.
Mr. Carter, I just want to tell you how excited I am about this term paper. It's all I can think about lately.
Really, Vinny?
Yeah.
I'm happy to see you so involved.
They called him Vinny back
then. I'm really into it.
Well, what subject are you going to write about?
What?
What subject have you decided to do your term paper on?
He starts having some academic problems, I think.
Give me a second, I'll think of it.
Does it have anything to do with history?
Yeah, the great French fry phantom.
French fry phantom?
Yeah, I just heard the news, no potatoes. I think it happened in the island, someplace where they speak English really funny.
As opposed to Brooklyn, where we speak it perfectly.
Yes.
What are you talking about, French fry phantom?
The phantom, you know, when you can't get nothing to eat, you have a phantom.
famine. The famine. French fry famine? Irish potato famine?
Yeah, that's it. That's it.
Anyway, wow. That was exclusive footage from the Mooch.
The Mooch.
In high school.
Still has the same hairdo, too.
I know.
Wow.
He was doing a report on the French fry phantom.
Well, that's incredible.
Yeah, I had some academic problems.
Yeah.
But I guess he cleaned that up and then became a hedge fund manager on Wall Street.
Right.
What are you going to do?
What are you going to do? Yo, this the Mooch.
Send your Italian-American cards and letters to Jason at Turning Left.
TurningLeftRadio at gmail.com.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, I mean, come on.
At themooch.com. Oh, my gosh. Man, that's just like two huge blockbuster things set in our lap at once.
That's right.
Holy cow. I don't know how to deal with it. I'm going to be processing this all weekend.
Yeah.
When people say, Jason, why do you got that look on your face? I'm just going to, yo, themooch.
Yeah. You know? Yeah, it just doesn't to get any better than that.
No.
Yeah.
I did not know the Mooch was a sweat hog. I didn't know that.
This shoe seems to fit.
Yeah. Oh, that blows my mind.
Yeah, yeah.
The Mooch.
Oh, brother.
Anyway, wow.
Hopefully we're still rolling here from the copyright stuff.
Sure.
It was fair use. It was for parody and...
Yeah, it was...
Stuff.
You know, I think the algorithm just writes for music. I don't think it's so much on...
Yeah, you play the Jimi Hendrix music and...
Right. And then it freaks out.
Right.
Right. Or like a retro thing for a NuzBox spot. Next thing you know, copyright.
Yeah, I know, right?
I got new music for that, by the way.
Oh, good.
I'm going to rip it out.
And yeah, we got lots. There's new music coming.
It's even better than the first one, too. I like it.
Oh, good.
Yes. And it's totally copy, royalty free, copyright free.
Yeah.
Public domain sort of stuff.
Well, so, you know.
Yeah.
The works of Martin Scorsese are public domain, right? Right?
Sure.
For parody.
Sure.
That's all I could think about last night when I'm listening to him on CNN.
Yeah.
Was that scene from Goodfellas? That's all I could think about.
For the longest time. When
I was just like, yeah, you were like, who does he remind me of?
He reminds me of somebody. I was like, oh my God.
You think I'm funny?
Yeah.
Do you think I'm funny?
Do I amuse you? Am I a clown?
Am I a clown? Do I amuse you? Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's like, I have to save his Twitter account because I.
Ooh, because there's going to be gold nuggets popping up there.
He tweeted, okay, so the thing is. I can't remember this sequence of events. I think it was before the New Yorker and the CNN. He did a late night tweet, the Mooch.
Oh yeah.
About the leaks and all that stuff and Rance Priebus, and then he deleted the tweet, and then he came back later and he said, "What you mucks? Yeah, I was just pointing out that he's helping me. We're good friends."
Right. I'm sure him and Rance are sitting around the office, you know, playing shuffleboard. I'm sure that's going on.
All I know, according to the Mooch, is if you're in the White House, don't barge into Steve Bannon's office unannounced. You may not like what you find. What are you doing?
Wow, that's an eyeful. Steve. You know, for a bigger guy, you're limber for a bigger guy.
Jeez.
Wow.
Couldn't happen to a nicer fella.
Oh, wow.
You know what? When we...
Yeah.
Yeah. Just people aren't... Maybe that basket was... maybe Hillary was right about that basket. I don't
right.
know.
Right. Oh. This whole act
that's
not is...
apples in there. That's...
Yeah, Steve, I can't believe what you're doing. It's just so slow... Deplorable?
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, oh, my gosh. Basket's getting bigger, man. It started out as a fruit basket. Mm-hmm. Now it's, like, you know, full-fledged. I don't know. It's just a basket.
Deplorable.
Yeah.
Okay, so where do we go from here?
Yeah.
So there was some... we don't have sports, but we do have sports. Like, bunch of big soccer to talk about.
Right.
Soccer. But You're getting news pings. So North Korea, what's going on there?
Yeah, they launched another ballistic missile. This time, it was actually aimed at Japan, and it landed in the just off the shore. They're like what they call their economic zone for shipping and so forth and so on. And more information is coming in about it. They all the word that came out is yes. We can confirm that there was a launch, and it landed here, and it appears to be a ballistic missile.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's an interesting, I don't know, the hawks are on fire with that one. And part of the deal with that one is that, so if this guy just keeps doing his stuff, launching missiles and testing nukes.
It confirmed it's an ICBM, intercontinental. Mm. So, yes.
Wow.
Yes. This was said by the...
So, duck and cover, folks. They actually said that they were waiting for this.
Right.
Because this week was the anniversary of... was it the end of the war or whatever we called it? It was an anniversary.
It was kind of an armistice, I guess.
Or was it the start of the Korean War? Ooh, I can't remember.
That's something.
Korea was a non... It wasn't a declared war,
no,
was it?
No, it was a police action.
Ah.
Police action, yes.
One of many of those fun modern police actions.
Yes. Brought to you by.
Yeah, yeah. But that was the first one, right?
Yeah, and technically, Korea. It's still going on.
Yes,
it never ended.
Yeah. I think maybe...
It's like the new 100 years.
Wrong. I think maybe it was the start of the police action, perhaps.
I believe you're right. I think it marks
the beginning. There's the anniversary, so they're waiting for this guy, Kim Jong-un.
Un and the Mooch.
To launch another.
Yo, Un. Yeah. The Mooch.
Yo, we're coming at you.
Coming at you.
Yeah. Yeah, cue the scene of the month. Go get your shoe shine box.
Don't say that to him. Don't say that to him. Yo.
Yeah. I'll tell you what. Go bada get bing. Your shoe shine box. Yeah, bada bing.
We're going to send stuff over there. Bada bing, bada boom. Next thing you know, you're in a trunk. Okay? Okay, Un. You're in a trunk.
Yeah.
Listen to me, the Mooch.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Oh, my word. He was over at his mom's house, too.
Well, he
probably needed to get a saw and have some spaghetti.
Right.
It's been so long since I've seen that movie. And I was like, I got to watch this movie again. It was one of my favorite. I mean, it's Scorsese and some of his finest.
It is. It's one of my favorite movies.
And I know people say Casino.
Yeah.
Casinos. But boy, Goodfellas.
Goodfellas. I love the music. Boy, oh boy. The music cutaways. I go from rags to riches.
Paul Sorvino.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Mm. So you got so many of them there.
Great actor. Paul Sorvino.
Paul Sorvino. Mm-hmm. Robert De Niro. Joe Pesci. Ray Liotta.
Brilliant.
That was his breakout role, right?
Yeah, he's brilliant. Oh.
Yeah, Paul Sorvino, though. I mean, how authentic does that guy look as the, like, the capo de capo, you know?
Yeah. Was it the...
Yeah.
Who played his wife? Was it the gal who was in The Sopranos, too? Played his wife? Anyway.
Oh, let's see. Ray Liotta's wife was Lorraine Bracco?
Yeah, the from the... who then ended up in The Sopranos, right?
Yeah.
Right? Wasn't she the psychologist?
I
think whatever. Yeah. Send your cards and letters to Jason Allen at Turning Left.
Yeah, I think you're right. Send your cards and letters. Yeah.
So the Mooch. So missiles and the thing is, so what I understand is the deal is the way we've always dealt with North Korea is we go and do like peace talks and stuff.
Yeah.
And then they agree to do things and we send over stuff. I guess.
Food.
There's diplomacy. So I've heard people who are experts in North Korea say, we're doing this wrong, and this is how you deal with North Korea. I mean, they're a thorn in the side, but they're a thorn in the side with nukes.
Right.
And bad people. Un family, the leaders.
It's always been the protocol was it's the long game. We bottle them up.
Yeah,
deep state. If they're not a threat.
Deep state, they're like ambassadors, CIA, and all that. That's how you're supposed to deal with that. And it's kind of and China, and maybe a little Russia too. Yeah. We all kind of like, okay, this is what we're gonna do. The biggest fear.
Yeah.
No, they sent this thing to Japan. That's interesting.
Yeah, it wasn't just out into the Sea of Japan. Mm-hmm. They fired it directly at Japan.
So the interesting thing, excuse me, there is that what we're most worried about is that they do something invade on the border, mm-hmm. and hit like Seoul, South Korea.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, South Korea, huge ally, capitalist state. I mean, folks, yeah. All your electronic. Oh, Samsung. Oh. Samsung. Where is that made?
Hyundai.
South Korea. Yeah. Yeah. So a lot of economic things. And of course, that's the problem. See, the Chinese, they like that economic action too. So true. Japan and South Korea. South Korea being a powerhouse. Also, the island of Taiwan. Those are all kind of thorns
or
in the
Formosa
side.
Formosa for you retro people. Yeah.
Right. Those are all thorn in the side of China.
Right.
Because of because they're economic powerhouses. If you look at Japan, originally the pioneers in electronics and all that, and then later Taiwan.
South Korea, Taiwan, and China.
Well, Taiwan actually has a lot of the offshore, what we call fabs, outside of the U.S. Yeah. Fabrication, that's where the chips are made.
Yes.
Multi-billion dollar factory. These are clean rooms. This isn't just like, oh, yeah, we're just going to set up a garage here and make a chip. You know, we're talking microscopic lithography, and you have to have a clean room. One dust speck blows out the electronics. So there's a lot of those out there in like Taiwan and, of course, in South Korea. Sure. And if North Korea acts up and attacks, and I didn't, you know, Seoul is actually close up in the north of South Korea.
It is. It's literally right over the border. I mean, they said that if any shenanigans went down, literally the North Koreans could hit them with artillery.
Yeah.
It's that close.
They got lots of artillery. They don't need nukes.
No.
It would be very bad for North Korea to do that. Anyway, so they use this thing. And now, to be fair, all the experts I've heard said Obama did not do a very good job here. And it makes sense that he didn't do a very good... I mean, if you really look at it, I mean, this has been kind of escalating. W, kind of the same. I mean, they both kind of like dropped the ball.
Yeah.
I believe Clinton... Bill Clinton
had a pretty tough.
They did okay with the North Koreans, like kind of like tough love, and I think that's their nuclear reactors and all that stuff were sealed under Bill Clinton.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
But there's a lot of you just have to listen to the experts. We're not experts at North Korea,
nor do we play them on TV.
No, and I'm not by experts. I don't mean Dennis Rodman.
Right. Okay. Yeah.
I mean, the actual ambassadors, CIA analysts, and people who are actually have done this for an entire living.
The guys that get paid.
Yeah. Their job is North Korea. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of problems with that. And to a certain degree, you could say that this situation was inherited. By Trump. Okay, so you can't just pin it on Trump and say,
no.
Oh, this is his problem. No, this has been ongoing. Obama administration has been struggling with this, and it's been kind of a mess. Now, I I'm not an expert, so it's hard for me to pass judgment on this to say who is wrong, who's right. I'm just saying what the experts say.
Yeah, I don't think there's anyone really wrong in this. I mean, they've taken kind of the macro view that they take towards Cuba. And that is seal them up, make sure they're not a threat, and hopefully time will deal with it on its own.
Right, right.
So, you know, and North Korea, I mean, they're so, let's call it what it is. They are bat crap crazy.
Well.
And so what you do is you just kind of, you try to make inroads through humanitarian aid while gently... kind of expressing that, you know, we would like you to cooperate on certain levels. And then, of course, the Chinese, of course, that share a border with them.
There's your problem right there. I mean, China is very disingenuous.
No, yes, they are.
And it's because of this economic play between South Korea, Taiwan, China. To this day, claims the island of Taiwan.
Yeah.
We had Trump did that thing about China where he went against policy and called Taiwan China, and the PRC doesn't like that.
No,
and we're standing off. We're flying planes in each other's faces and all that. So this is not good. I mean, it would be great to get some sort of breakthrough with because North Korea is dangerous. This is a dangerous situation. Can I speak? What was that? Situation.
You sounded like the Moochster. Situation over there. Over there.
I'm Wolf Blitzer. Welcome to the situation room.
Yeah.
I'm here with the Mooch.
Yo, the Mooch.
So, so this is crazy, and it's not getting any good.
I think, unfortunately, we have, and I know this, I'm saying this, man, he's so bubbly today. No, I mean, I think we passed the point of, I won't say no return, but I think we've passed the point where where we can just walk it back. Because, I mean, they're stepping up their stuff, and I think they've reached that critical mass of being able to now have a delivery system.
That's the scare, and that's what all analysts agree, that this is not a good situation.
4 out of 5 dentists have said.
And one analyst I heard just this week was talking about and said, You know, all this wonderful hardware that the North Koreans are making end up in Tehran, too, you know?
Right.
It was like, oh, yeah, that's right.
That's another major source of North Korea exports, right? Yeah. Is they sell a lot of their stuff to Tehran.
I'm trying to remember
Iran.
What they called. There's a nickname for it, but anyway, don't want to get into it. But the problem is the way the current administration looks at it is, and this is another thing that's military. This is a profit opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
So North Korea. So if this guy's acting up and doing stuff, well, that means you need missiles, defenses, more ships and military and all that stuff. So what we get is the United States has protected our allies, our countries, you know, and by allies I mean stuff that happened after World War II,
mm-hmm.
right? Japan, for example, Germany, Western Europe, all out of the Cold War. But now, I mean, this whole thing is we want them to pay for it. And that's a profit opportunity for our defenses.
Right.
So, in a way, you could make the argument that this isn't such a bad thing for people who, want to sell military systems made in the United States to our friends in Japan or South Korea, for example. So that's what they say.
It's funny that whenever there's tension in the world, military contractors worldwide see a boost
mm-hmm.
in their profits and in their stock prices.
Well, there was I had a saved article from weeks ago last month.
Mm-hmm.
The head of one of the big military contractors and Trump was out there buddying, you know, so there you go.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know. I fall more on the peace, diplomacy, and prosperity.
Right.
Rather than prosperity through war. But, it's looking dangerous out there.
At the moment, yeah.
And that's not to say that, North Korea, bad things there. But,
right.
You know, and they're talking about they were talking about this week about Hawaii. But, maybe we need to sell some stuff to Hawaii to protect. And, like, oh, there you go. That's interesting. So,
right. Mm.
I don't know. I don't know.
I don't know. It's very, very.
I mean, and we're just talking recent, like, because of this missile.
Yeah.
Happened as we were going here on the air. So.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, my fear is at some point we'll be doing this. And, at some point it'll be like, okay, Jason, sorry, I'm going to be under the desk.
Duck and cover.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny.
We're just going to be cracking jokes under the desk. Hope we don't all die.
Right.
And that was a nice thought for a Friday.
Well, yeah, but, think about this, too, is one day in the future when we say coming to you live out of the bomb shelter,
yeah,
it's not going to be metaphorically. I mean, it's going to be literally. Hi, folks, we're down here in the bomb shelter. Oh, happy Friday. Hope you still got your Twinkies on hand because, you know, they're one of the few food items that can survive a nuclear attack is Twinkies. You know, and share.
Oh, and, man.
We could literally be doing it from the bomb shelter, which could be cool. Reminds me of that movie Blast from the Past. Mm-hmm. Do you remember that? Alicia Silverstone, Brendan Fraser. Who played Dad? Was it Christopher Walken?
I don't know. No.
I think he did. I think he played the father. It's like this. They thought the nuclear war was going to happen in the 50s, so they all jumped down into their bomb shelter and set a time code release.
Mm-hmm.
And
oh, yes. I do remember that one. They're all living in the bomb shelter. I do think that was Walken.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fabulous.
Yeah. That's right. Brendan now I remember. Fraser, they're basically.
Sissy Spacek is the mother.
Yeah, they come out of the bomb shelter or whatever.
Yeah.
And it's like.
Well, they set up Brendan Fraser to kind of see what's going on. Yeah. So he shows up and then hijinks ensue.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, I do. Now I know which one you're talking about now. That was a good one. Yeah, I think Walken was the dad on that one. Right. Another great Walken piece. Yeah. So according to the Hill, House Judiciary Committee votes to request documents on Comey and Clinton.
Oh, gosh, yeah. This is the GOP and the rights now trying to hijack the narrative of the Russian investigation.
So, to bring it back in fair and balanced.
Right.
I love saying that. Debbie Wasserman Schultz.
She...
one of my favorite people in the Democrat Party.
Yeah.
That wasn't my middle finger. That was, I was just.
Right, right.
It was my index finger.
Right.
He
had my lash in there, okay, folks? Yeah. Come on.
All right. So, how did this work out? So, she's got an IT guy from, what do I want to say, Pakistan?
Yes.
A whole family. And they were doing the IT for the Democrats.
The DNC, yeah.
And then there's missing laptops and smashed hard drives.
Yep.
And then I actually watched this thing.
Mm-hmm.
And this is, this is something that if you're just watching MSNBC or CNN, you may not see. You might have to go to Fox to actually get this, but it's actual news.
Go figure, yeah.
She was in and it was right there. I couldn't believe it. I mean, I read this. It might have been like one of the New York Times or something picked this up. But they have a committee meeting for the budget for the Washington, D.C. police.
Mm-hmm.
And because, Congress, they appropriate all the budget for Washington, D.C.
Yeah.
And the police. And, of course, the D.C. police are part of their charter is to protect Congress.
Right. Not only is it the D.C. police, they have their own autonomous Capitol Police.
Yes.
And they're the guys that are outside the buildings. They're.
But D.C.
Yeah.
D.C. is most everything that happens in D.C. is act of Congress.
Falls under the purview, right?
Right.
Yeah.
And that's been an issue over the years.
Yeah.
For people who actually live in actual D.C.
There's a lot of territorial conflict where you just don't. There's some areas you don't know who's in charge.
So they have the chief of police in D.C. And I'm not going to pull it up here. I'm just going to tell you this, or you can go look at it. Chief of police in D.C., and he's there in committee. This is about the budget for the Washington, D.C. police. Mm-hmm. And she's grilling him about the laptop. She's like, you have my laptop. It was reported stolen. I want it back. And he's like, Yeah, well, I don't know what, you know, where there's an investigation, because there's an investigation. What the deal was is the FBI, I think, caught her IT guy getting on a plane
trying to flee the
with
country,
a bunch of cash to flee the country. And he did like a shifty, what I read is they got a loan out on a rental house that they didn't own. So
shady.
Complete 100% bank fraud.
Yeah.
You know, that's basically like if I took a loan out on some, you know, your house. Who knows?
Sweet.
Right. Yeah.
Okay.
That's a problem. And these folks are pretty shady.
Yeah.
They got a lot of shady stuff.
Yeah.
And they're doing all the IT, like for the DNC, Debbie Wasserman Schultz. And she fired him then when they picked him up. But she hasn't fired them up to that point.
No.
And, of course, the right is like, what does these people have on Debbie Wasserman Schultz? And so she's practically screaming at the chief of police in committee to give her back the laptop. And he's,
you don't have nothing to hide when you're doing it, right?
This is an ongoing investigation.
Yeah.
And it's just her argument was, she's whack. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Debbie Wasserman Schultz was never good for the Democratic Party.
No.
You know where she got her money in Florida? Mm. A payday loan. Loans, people. Oh, that's a real social Democrat. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, this is why?
It's like once,
why did we lose?
Right.
Take a walk down the Debbie Wasserman Schultz thing, and don't tell me. I mean, she spent most of her time on like the news things, talking about this and that. I've never thought she was good for the Democratic Party. No. Howard Dean, I don't think is good for the Democrat these days. Yeah. But anyway, so that I'm going down that path.
She was so
hammered on this. Now everyone's like, what are you worried about? What are you suspicious of?
Yeah.
You got to look this up. I mean, I watched the video from the committee.
Yeah.
And you can find it if you Google it. And you're like, huh. Because wouldn't you be concerned about your IT guy and the FBI and all the shady stuff? Well, you fired him, finally. I mean, it was already under indictment. Oh, man.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Maybe her days are numbered. Political days are numbered, I think.
Yeah.
They already were.
She got booted out of office pretty much unceremoniously.
But she did win her election.
She did.
Surprisingly. I was very surprised. And wasn't there another Democrat that was running against her and was like running on these issues? Like, you know, she's taking payday loan money and all this stuff. There was some other more liberal, you know.
Yeah. But
in tune Democrat.
But she had the money behind her and just swamped the ad time. And, yeah. Yeah, that is the one thing I think the Democrats have failed to deal with. And that's just because when she left doesn't mean all that shadiness just suddenly goes away.
No.
I mean, she's one person, right? The people that she's working with and the sort of institutionalized the way they do business doesn't end with that. And I think that is a great detriment to the Democratic Party.
Right. You know? So I think, I actually think what's going on here is you've got, tie it back to this news item, you got House Judiciary Committee wants to get Comey and Clinton.
And Loretta Lynch.
Well, let's go back down memory lane.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
What happened? My plane just happened to land on the tarmac.
Yeah.
And the former president just happened to be in his plane on the tarmac.
Yeah.
So we just texted each other and said, hey, why don't you come over and just hop in the plane? We'll just shoot the stuff, you know?
Right.
How's the grandkids? Grandkids are good. Oh, that's great. Family's great.
Mm.
Where are you going? Oh, yeah. How was the last vacation? Great. How was the beach? Wonderful. Well, that's great, Loretta. That's great, Mr. President. See you later.
Adios, right.
Do you think that's how that happened?
Not a chance.
But that's what Loretta Lynch said happened.
Yeah.
That was the public story.
It was. I
just two planes meeting in the...
But I'm not getting...
You're so being played, America. Yeah. Anyway.
But I'm just not getting, I'm not seeing the, especially with Comey, I'm not seeing the connection.
No, but, well,
I mean, Schultz, yeah, she's shady. For
but the allegation like almost, of Lynch is that she, yeah, she met with Bill Clinton, and that there was some collusion in the investigation on the Hillary Clinton email server business by Justice Department.
Yeah.
At a minimum, to everyone, this is not a good look.
No, it's not. And
the Justice Department is supposed to be independent.
But I kind of get the feeling, though, I mean, that I don't think Lynch, per se, is shady.
But I beg to differ a little bit on that one.
Well, I see.
There's some stuff.
I'm sure. No. Yeah, I'm sure there's some partisanship. Yeah. I kind of see the whole plane episode thingity as the ladies on the. I mean, just sitting there, and then the former president walks on board. I mean, what are you going to do? Kick him out?
Right.
I mean, it's just not like you can throw out an ex-president and say, get out of here, you know? I mean, it was probably...
I can see that. Between a rock and a hard place.
Yeah.
And then you're like...
I can see it more instigated from Bill's side.
Yeah.
You know, hey, you know, I want to grease the wheel.
Yeah, he got something there. Down here. Yeah, maybe.
Maybe you could, you know.
Yeah.
And, so I don't know.
And then what you got to do is, I'm sorry, and then once that happens... Yeah. What are you supposed to do? Maybe recuse yourself.
Yeah. Yeah.
At that point, and go, well, you know.
Yeah, the whole thing is so muddy, though.
This is Justice Department, so.
Right. But the whole thing is so muddy, though, because when you're talking about the spring and then summertime, I mean, everything was just.
Yeah.
I mean, you had all the WikiLeaks. You had all the stuff going on. And I don't know. I'm going to plead ignorance on this one, especially when it comes to Lynch and X. I think
what's going down with all this, which will be probably fun to watch, I think.
Must-see TV, right?
We've got Mueller.
Bob Mueller.
On one side.
Mm-hmm.
And he's digging down, and you know he's digging down into what's going on with Trump.
And look at the people he hired.
Junior.
That alone.
And Kushner and all these folks.
Manafort.
That will be fun.
Now DeMooch. Bada boom. Yeah. Yo.
That's going to be all interesting and fun.
Yeah.
And excited to see what turns up there.
Stay tuned.
And then you're going to have judiciary digging into the Clinton side, too. Right. So we're just going to have stuff flying everywhere.
It is. This is the counter.
It'll be what do they call it? Mutual destruction, right?
Right.
Which. I predict it'll get to that point. You know, Republicans will get all their dirt on the Democrats.
Yeah.
Democrats will have all the dirt on Trump and the GOP.
Yeah.
And you know what happens when that happens? They go into session behind closed doors.
Sure.
And
work it out.
Deal with their cigars and their stuff, and they work it out. And then they come out, and everything's fine. It's fine. Sweat and American people, you'll never...
Right.
Nothing happens.
Right.
So hopefully a lot of good stuff will leak from that.
And right.
You know.
But actually, I think at the end of the day, maybe some things will happen and unintended consequences. I mean, the rank and file, especially millennials and the youngers, they are ready to throw up their hands and walk away. Like, both you guys suck, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that's going to be at the end of the day, is going to be a large segment of people are going to take that stance. Like, you're crooked, we're tired of the whole thing, you know, and just disengage and walk away, which is sad, because at this pivotal moment in history, we need an engaged citizenry, right? So that's my one and a half cents before taxes.
Well, worth. I just, I don't know.
But
the Pollyanna world that you're living in right now, I don't know.
Pie in the sky.
I was just trying to see what was trending.
Yeah, what is trending?
It's pretty much we're nailing it.
Yeah.
You know, you got this guy who crashes his 200,000 Ferrari.
Yeah.
Whatever. But we do have some sports.
Yeah.
I found the good
I got some entertainment news real quick.
Ooh.
for the first time ever, right? Uh-oh. First time ever.
Better be good.
Oh, you're going to love this. The Emoji Movie?
Oh, yes.
For the first time ever, the Emoji Movie has achieved the impossible. A 0% rating on Rotten Tomatoes.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, it's so horrible.
I saw a little blurb about that this morning. The Emoji Movie.
Yes.
Remember that, what was that, a year or two ago, that Adam Sandler movie where it was like the Pac-Mans and they were all kind of came alive and they were fighting like the computer game
stuff. I don't know, yeah.
Yeah, I don't even remember what it was called. And that movie, people were like, oh, that's not going to be so good, right?
Right.
And it kind of came out and flopped. And I thought, oh, Emoji Movie? Oh, didn't you learn your lesson, Hollywood? Because this thing's, yeah. Make good movies.
Yeah. Get something else to do for you.
Yeah.
Can you believe, right? This is going to make you feel old.
Okay.
Rick Astley marks the 30th anniversary of his best-known song. Never gonna give you up, never gonna let you down. And he made a tweet about it. He wants his fans and everyone to know that he will not give anyone up ever. All right, Rick Astley. Where do you come on?
First Rick roll we've ever had on this show.
Right, the Rick roll. So, Doc, where do you come down on the Rick Astley issue?
Actually, we're in the works with our own Rick roll.
Sweet!
A new Rick roll.
Sweet!
It's not Rick Astley. It's not Never Gonna Give You Up.
Yeah.
But because we've been... It's so good.
All these exclusives coming down the pike, you know?
It involves the universe and the cosmos.
Ooh, I like it. I like it.
And
well, because nothing says Zen like Rick Astley.
Evening wear. Anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that'll be fun. There was some vegan news. I don't want to. I want to get into the sports.
Oh, let's.
But there was. Yeah, there's. I will just say yes. Saw it.
Jay-Z here for the sports thing.
I saw it. Well, I got soccer.
Gotcha.
But there's this dietitian nutritionist. And I've actually encountered her before online and her writings. She's essentially anti-vegan. And she was on a TV show. She's in Britain and on a TV show. And basically, I would never recommend don't vegan. And of course, you know, that blew up the internet. Actually, if you read her blog and read some of her writings, especially the one about milk and lactose intolerance, she throws some shade at Asians, as in a very uncomfortable way.
Uh-oh.
Like talking about I'm not sure how to put it, but I read this thing and I'm like, no, you're wrong. And then it was like,
yeah.
Whoa, because she points out that Japanese and a lot of Asians do not have lactose intolerance. You're lacking
the enzyme. That is another Jimmy the Greek thing, is it?
I read this thing, and if you read between the lines,
oh, no.
I'm like, okay, this person's a crap hat.
yeah.
You know, suggesting that those cultures that aren't lactose intolerant and I'm thinking, God, those 3,000 years of civilization that the Chinese have without worrying about drinking milk. She's got some sort of agenda.
Yeah.
I've encountered her before online.
Yeah.
And she got her 15 minutes of fame on TV. Mm. And one person I did retweet this said, you know, if you're a dietitian for 10 years or 13 years and you can't figure out which vegetables to eat for nutrition, maybe you should get another job. obviously, vegans weren't happy about it. Mm. Yes, you can make cases. There's some certain medical conditions, I believe, where you have deficiencies in vitamins and things like B vitamins and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And there are deficiencies among the culture. Well, you know, you can take supplements. There are tons of examples of vegetable sources for that.
Yeah.
Before I was a vegan, I actually was under the impression that being a full-on vegan was unhealthy.
Not at all.
And it turned out I was wrong. And it surprised me too. But
Because isn't it usually the big thing is, what about the protein?
Yeah,
what are you going to do about the protein?
And it turns out, well, I kind of did the whole evolutionary thing.
Mm.
Omnivore evolutionary thing, which is true. But it turns out, Jason, it turns out, you know, human beings through their evolution, as I think I've said before, didn't always get meat all the time.
Nope.
You had to go hunt it out. You had to go find it out.
Yeah.
Being an omnivore was very advantageous, right? For example, if you're a species that is pure carnivore, cats, right? That sort of thing. You're really up a crick if you can't, you know,
if you don't know how to fish,
get your meat.
Yeah.
And so those species are disadvantaged.
Yes.
But humans, as we talked about the Neanderthals, and all you think about Neanderthal cavemen running around
roasting haunches over an open fire.
And we're finding, you know, we're digging, we're finding their teeth and all this stuff. Fruits and veggies all over the place, right? You know, you eat what's there. And it's modern times.
Yeah.
We know about nutrition, and we know where to get it.
Right.
I don't know. So right.
A lot of the work.
Here's the thing.
Okay.
When you make just a blanket statement like that, and you've got millions of people. And here's the thing. Vegetarian veganism, is this brand new for the 21st century?
Yeah.
No, there's all kind of cultures outside of Europe that have been doing this for a very, very long time and surviving. And by the way, her whole lactose intolerant thing, her little, and I'm not pulling it up, but I'm telling you, it was slightly racist.
Just a skosh.
Did you ever review, I would have to ask her, did you ever review the life expectancy of Asians versus Europeans and Westerners?
Right.
Because if you review that, you'll actually surprisingly find the lactose intolerant Asians have a higher life expectancy.
Right.
Overall.
Right.
Than us. And the other thing about lactose intolerance, there was just recent archaeological news about Neanderthals and that lactose intolerance was very prominent among the cavemen, all that too. So, so the whole thing, I mean, that's the whole debate about cow's milk. And yes, it's a protein bomb. Yes, like for kids growing up, has a lot of calcium. You can get calcium in other things too. And I'm always of the opinion growing bodies, kids are garbage cans.
Sure.
That's just how they work.
Yeah.
Try to get good nutrition in them, but their bodies are just going to absorb whatever because they're growing. Adults are dying. You are dying. Sorry.
Right. Happy Friday,
that's
everybody.
Feel good Friday.
That's right.
No, but biologically, if you really put it together, when you hit adulthood, you know, you're on the climb, you're growing, because you're growing, you're getting somewhere,
and
then you hit the peak, and then guess what?
You jump the shark, and then you're going down. Yeah.
You go here.
Yeah.
And so when you're eating, when you're an adult, you're eating for daily survival and hopefully to replenish your cells and all of that.
Right.
And you're not eating. You shouldn't be eating like a kid, you know. But anyway.
Bottom line, folks, no one gets out of here alive.
That's right.
You know, happy Friday.
And you can't take it with you.
Right. Literally.
So the whole thing about me, and I grew up with dairy. But as an adult, I stopped it. And I did some of the research. And I said, you know, dairy thing, it's not, you know, mother's milk is very important, and that's a good thing, and that's why they encourage that to happen, because there's all kinds of biological things that happen with the baby with the mom's human milk, including immunities and all sorts of stuff that that goes on, but I don't know. So that was a big controversy, and frankly, it's all BS. And, you know, you want to jump in, but then you're like, now let this person's 15 minutes of fame go. Here's the thing about dietitians. I'm just going to say this. The whole diet world, vegan, paleo, and all that stuff, it's full of BS to a certain degree. Yes, there's research, and you have to sort it out for yourself. Mm-hmm. Because especially the dietitians are influenced by a lot of things. Some are very good and do the research, but some are not. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure what this person's agenda is. I mean, there's when you read these studies that hit your news, you know, that says, I don't know, eating a steak and drinking a pot of coffee you'll live to be 120.
Live forever.
When you read that headline and you read that story, you got to think.
You got to think.
Does it make sense?
Right.
And you got to wonder what's behind that story. And usually it's some industry or whatever that's pushing pushing their agenda. I mean, there was the meat. Remember when we were growing up? But was it James Garner or whatever? What's for dinner?
Beef
for dinner. Remember? For dinner. That was a famous commercial that would come on back in the day.
Yes.
You know, it's what's for dinner, right? And that was the cattle council people
who sold
the steaks.
Yeah.
So until
the mad cow disease came forward, and then it's like pork, the other white meat.
Oh, God. Was that? Yeah, that they did that, right?
The other white meat, yes. Yeah,
just make sure you cook it and don't eat it raw.
Right.
You go crazy. but, yeah, you know, so there's a lot of that behind that industry. And lots of articles are written, you know, and you got to kind of go, what's the agenda here? Vegans have an agenda. The anti-veganism, I'll tell you what one of the arguments that you'll hear is it's bad on the environment, which I find fascinating because cattle farming, fertilizer and stuff messes with the water. So there's always a, you know, there's a, well, by bad on the environment.
How is being vegan bad for the environment?
Almonds use so much water. That's one of the things, right? There's a big thing about almonds and how much they use water. Yeah. So if you're using almond products, that's one argument I can come up with in my head. Yeah. Right? Farming, making all that stuff, or, you know, there's all kinds of anti- that kind of thing.
Interesting. Yeah.
But of course, the converse for years was what cattle farming does to the environment.
Yeah.
Which has a heck of a environmental impact.
Sure.
Ranches,
sure.
Especially the water table stuff goes in the water. So you just got to be balanced and find your way. But when people come out with these blanket statements like, you know, you need to eat like a caveman. Have a steak.
The paleo
at every
diet.
Meal.
The more raw, the better.
Know? And granted, people who eat meat and stuff probably think vegans are like that too. I don't know. But I can tell you it works.
Yeah.
It's, I
don't know.
Yeah. So anyway, so that happened.
You know,
I wasn't going to talk about
as this show goes on today, we're sounding like the mooch more and more. I don't know. Forget about
it. It's interesting because there was a story.
Yeah?
There is this, I just saved it. Speaking of veganism here.
I haven't done the ringer once today.
He hasn't.
No.
Okay. I don't have a reference. I don't have a reference, so I'm not going to talk about it.
Yeah.
Someone posted something about a vegan product that was bought by a pharmaceutical company.
Oh, boy.
Honestly, I'm not that particular product.
Yeah.
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 I mean, I've had it from time to time, and then I've been like, it's not so good.
It's not that quinoa, is it?
Sports.
Yeah. Oh, I said it's not that quinoa, is it?
No. Oh, okay, that's a natural grain.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah, no. No, that's like a... that grows. That's one of those ancient grains that they're always talking about.
Yeah.
And there's issues with that too. People talk about. So sports, soccer. There's been a lot of soccer.
Yeah.
And the big news in soccer, I would say, for us here, it was on Wednesday, was the Gold Cup.
Mm-hmm.
Did you see this one? Oh, it was a heck of a game. It was
Jamaica,
the final.
Yeah.
Jamaica.
Yeah.
And the United States. In the Gold Cup, and it was a heck of I watched it. It was a heck of a match. The other thing locally here for us, we had three players in the Gold Cup. You know, we've got Nagby, of course, who's a starter for the U.S. men's team, doing a great job. Nagby's, man, he's so fast. You know, we're just looking for him for goals, but he's taking the ball, he's getting it up there, he's doing what he does and making the plays. And he was doing a great job. And on Jamaica, there were two Timbers on the Jamaican team.
Yeah.
On the losing Jamaican team. And so that was a heck of a game. I didn't have the highlights, but it was a really good one if you want to watch the replay. Right. It was a hard-fought game. It wasn't, you know, none of these U.S. men's games, they're not really a walk in the park, you know?
No,
Mexico,
no.
Jamaica, I mean, these are well-matched. This was a well-matched.
Very competitive, right?
You know, U.S. got up by one goal. I think it was Altidore, I believe, got the first one.
Yeah,
and then Jamaica responded with the equalizer and was like, "Uh-oh." One of the big points in the match, which was very scary, Jamaica has a great goal goalkeeper.
Yeah,
and he did a double save the ball, like saved it once, ball's free, players coming in trying to make an attempt, second save, and then unfortunately he got hooked by one of the players and injured and had to go off, and he was in bandages, and so that was sad. Ouch. To see.
Yeah.
He won the Golden Glove of the game, and deservedly so, because he did such a great job defending. Unfortunately, got injured and had to be removed from the game. His replacement did a fine job as well, but that was kind of a bummer, because you don't want to see that. I mean, they had like a couple close-ups as he's on the field. It's like, oh, dude, don't show us his hand and his fingers and stuff. I mean, it's you know, it's like
a little graphic.
Yeah, it was. We were like, whoa, come on, okay. And it's like, well, it looks like he's really seriously injured there. It's like, yeah, can we tell by the close-up of his hand
mangled?
Shaking? I mean, it was like so. But I think they said he didn't break anything.
Good.
So maybe some dislocation. Location. I was like, ooh. And the winning goal was this guy. I can't remember his name, but this was played down in Santa Clara, and he was a local guy. Santa Clara. He went to the university down there, and all that. So it was huge, huge. So that was big. So with a CONCACAF Gold Cup, United States men's team, and they played great. Nagby. Yeah. The sad thing is. I had this all set up, but I don't have it. One of our guys on the Timbers.
Yeah.
The Jamaicans were a little upset with their loss.
Yeah.
I mean, they played a great game. This was not, you know, this was a fantastic game, and but they were upset. And I think they've been there before and gotten second place, and they really wanted to push. They were hoping to get first place. Our guy on the Timbers was visibly upset as he was getting his second place medal.
Yeah.
It was a little bit, it was like, people were like, okay, you know, you, it was a great game. Someone has to win, something has to lose.
Right,
but
he
was breaking down in something you usually don't see in sports.
He wasn't handling it well, huh?
Emotional.
Yeah.
So, but these guys were great. So, so there was that. Then right after that, Manchester City, Group 1 International Champions. Somebody said this was a friendly, but it wasn't. International Champions Cup, which they're playing there with the European. Manchester City and Real Madrid, 4-1 Manchester City.
Wow.
Blew them out. Yeah.
Wow.
Real Madrid. So that was a big, big game
there.
Up and coming. In the U.S. women's, I didn't catch that. They played a friendly with Australia last night. Where did that? I wanted to see what the score was.
Yeah.
I missed that. Yeah, I don't. Okay. I don't see it. Unless I'm looking at today. Okay. Anyway, so there they were playing, and of course the big thing with the U.S. men's team and all that is World Cup is next year in Russia. So it's the next thing, and that team is really coalescing, really looking good.
Get some Neymar news.
Yes, there is Neymar news.
Yeah, Neymar involved in Barcelona's training bust up and proposed PSG move.
Yes, so that's the rumor. Yes. We talked about that last week, that he may be leaving.
Yes.
Barcelona.
Going to Paris Saint-Germain.
Yeah. And they're trying to get him in the Premier League. So we have a huge Timbers match coming up tomorrow, Saturday. Actually, we got some big matches. International, that Champions Cup International.
Right.
Chelsea versus Internacional. That's at 4 a.m. and then we've got some big ones, more at reasonable hours, tomorrow. Yeah. Manchester City versus Tottenham.
Yeah, the Hotspurs.
At 3 p.m. So that's
go Hotspurs.
No, these. So the Chelsea
is,
one. But,
is that on TV?
Oh, yeah. ESPN, baby.
Oh, I'm watching it.
Yeah.
I'm DVRing.
No, you're going to have two Hotspurs. Matches.
Yeah.
3 p.m.
3 p.m.
Man City and the Hotspurs go at it.
Yeah,
and at 5 p.m., Real Madrid and Barcelona go at it.
I know what I'm
doing. For the International Champions Cup tomorrow.
I know what I'm doing. Plus, we got Timbers, right?
And we got the Timbers. Timbers got a big match. Houston Dynamo at 5 p.m.
Ooh, hopefully that's televised, too.
Yeah. Oh.
Fairly good chance.
Yeah. And Houston, that's an interesting one because Houston, number 3, Portland Timbers number 4 on the tables.
Yeah.
This is
a need.
Mm-hmm.
This is a need win.
Mm-hmm.
Go Timbers.
So that's some soccer stuff that I'm following. And the other thing about soccer, Jason, what I told you I found out. We talked about the old days of American soccer, the NASL.
Yeah.
And you know, that's when the Timbers got to start. Pele, who played on this team, the New York Cosmos, super team. So we had Pele, we had Franz Beckenbauer from Germany, all the great Canalia from Italy. I found out yesterday.
Yeah.
I am so dumb.
Okay.
Jason, did you know the NASL still exists?
I did not know that.
And not only that, so do the New York Cosmos.
Wow. I do not know that.
So really? I read this whole history.
Yeah.
Now, what happened was...
Wow.
There's 3 leagues.
Yeah.
There's the MSL, right?
Or Major League MLS.
MLS, thank you.
Uh-huh.
Which is the Division I.
Yeah.
Timbers are MLS. That was a big deal. Mm-hmm. You know, the Timbers were not, and then they got improved the stadium. Merritt Paulson is like... We're going in the MLS.
Yeah.
Huge deal, right? That's going into the NBA or whatever. That's you're in the number one. Increase your attendance, increase your television and all that.
Yep.
So MLS is Division I.
Yes.
So there's a USL Division II.
Right.
And the NASL Division II. And what the deal is the NASL was the original Division I.
Yeah.
Soccer.
Yeah.
And it lasted till the early 80s. So it started in the 70s. Timbers were a founding member. In fact, the first year, the Timbers went to the championship.
Wow.
And lost to the Rowdies.
Ooh, the Rowdies.
Yes, yes.
I like that name.
Tampa Bay.
Tampa Bay Rowdies. There are a bunch of Rowdies down there in Tampa.
And if I went through all my sports memorabilia, we could pull that out and look at that. And then we had the Cosmos, and they well-funded team, and they brought over Pele late in his career.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was awesome. And this was all to boost soccer in America through the 70s into the early 80s.
Yeah.
Well, NASL had financial problems, and the league ended up folding in the early 80s. Then it went away. And then there was an indoor soccer league, and the Timbers survived through all of this.
Yeah.
That was the bizarre thing. Like, once NASL folded, and the Timbers kind of went with that because they were part of NASL.
Yeah.
And then I remember people were going to indoor soccer league.
Yeah.
And it was the Portland Timbers. And I was like, God, the Timbers are still, you got to go to the indoor. I never went to any of those indoor soccer. Sorry to say.
Yeah.
But because I was like, indoor soccer? Indoor, this, you
kind of like arena football.
Yeah. It's like, I don't put peanut butter on my chocolate, sir. No, No. I mean, but you know, it just, I don't know. That don't just seem right. Indoor soccer.
But it was a thing for a while. Yeah.
I know people probably will fight me on that, and that's fine. It just, you know.
Yeah.
So they did the indoor soccer league.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then the Timbers came back up, and I can't. Were they in USL? I think. Yeah. So these other leagues were formed. Yeah. These Division II, and then MLS came up. Yeah. And you know, you do Division I, you got certain capacity and money and all sorts of things, and, right. and you get sanctioned by the U.S. Soccer, which is part of the International Soccer, which is like FIFA and all those guys, right?
Right.
Guys who are all going to jail right now.
Yeah, you know, there's some stuff
that was
going
a little Loretta Lynch move, by the way, FIFA. Taking it back to Loretta Lynch. Remember?
Yeah.
She and the FBI busted all those soccer guys.
Right.
How quickly we forget.
Mm-hmm.
She must have been a baseball fan.
she must be a Yankees fan.
No, no, they were corrupt.
They're Washington Nationals, maybe.
So anyway. So then these guys, these investors, formed the NASL, like in the 2000s-ish.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And the Cosmos were always like kind of an entity at some point, just like the Timbers were with the indoor soccer and all that. And so the Cosmos had some ownership I don't want to go into the details of who owned what. And there was the dude from over from... not Liverpool, but one of the teams who became a co-owner. Mm-hmm. So the Cosmos have been around for a while, like the same logo and everything. And the NASL, the new NASL, same logo. It was like wow. And they said, "Well, we want to name it this because we want to respect the pioneers of American soccer."
Sure.
Really good. Okay, fine. So they're still there, and then they're fighting with the USL, and then the Cosmos get in. And then there's issues, but it was like 2015, I want to say, 2013, then 2015, that things kind of settled out and that the Cosmos are kind of in their place. And they wanted to get into, they got this guy. They ended up selling, the British guys sold their ownership to this guy. And his name, kid you not, Rocco.
Oh, yeah. Rocco and the merch.
Rocco.
Yo, Rocco.
Oh, this guy's straight from Italy, too.
Yeah.
Rocco, and he's like a news broadcaster guy. I don't know. You can look up it. Look up the Wikipedia. It's fascinating. Mm. So, Rocco. So, they have wanted to get the Cosmos in to the MLS, right?
Yeah.
Because Cosmos are...
I'm surprised that they're, you know...
One of the teams. Well, the Rowdies, I think, or the San Jose. I mean, there's a couple teams that existed with the Timbers back in the old NASL that are not in MLS.
Mm.
And so it was a big deal when we, the Timbers, went into the MLS. I mean, Seattle Sounders is another one of the NASL teams.
That's true.
I mean, that Seattle everyone Sounders. Looks at the rivalry between Seattle Sounders and Timbers.
Yeah.
Well, that started in 77 or 75, you know, so that's been around forever. So the Cosmos are playing in the NASL. And then the NASL and the USL, they're kind of fighting each other because they're both Division II.
Right. Yeah.
So I'm fascinated by this.
Yeah.
And now, of course, we have the Red Bulls, New York Red Bulls,
right.
MLS.
Right.
And so they're a powerhouse. And they're actually trying to get some...
Doesn't New York have two teams now?
Yes. Yeah. Red Bulls and
then just like the New York FC.
That one is the one that is... I can't remember what English team is associated with that.
Mm.
That's the one where I think Lampard went to. Frank.
Mm.
Anyway.
Okay.
So so they have a couple teams. And you know, and then we have, you know, these kind of American expansion teams that are tied to like say Premier League teams and all that. So it's all really good for American soccer.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. It's all real positive. But the Cosmos are there, and so I'm just like, wow, you know, with the same logo and everything, like
that's
back
cool.
when Pele played with them, and I'm just like, wow, you know.
They live on.
Yeah, I mean, that's cool. It'd be interesting to see like team like that. You know, the old logo teams go into MLS. Now, of course, right. Timbers famously, you know, the logo is different too.
Yeah,
modern Timbers, but it's still the axe and the yeah, whatever you call
there's,
that. The,
there's still
the
a lot stripes. Of similarities. Yeah, it's just a little updated. You know.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. I still got all my old logo stuff. We have somewhere. We have original NASL balls too. It was this Ooh. Blue and white and wow. with stars. Yeah,
that's cool.
Oh yeah, they kick them in the stands.
Awesome.
Like really nice ball. No wonder they financially
right,
had yeah. problems. They were kicking these really nice leather soccer balls that were legit.
Yeah.
Play, you know, it's like throwing championship yeah. footballs or something out and say, yeah. "Hey, go ahead and keep it."
Yeah, we're gonna need those back.
No.
I got a little excited.
They do those promotions too. They'd sign them.
Oh wow! No,
the team would sign them and then kick them up in the stand.
That's cool.
Yeah, back that was the old days, though.
Yeah,
those soccer balls probably cost you $12 or something.
Yeah.
Now they're like
50, 60.
Yeah, who knows, man?
Yeah.
Anyway, so that's my big
soccer
fish
roundup,
soccer story.
Yeah.
But I just thought that was crazy. I did not know that. These teams are still around and in some yeah. form or another.
That's really
and
cool.
Rightly so. I mean, yeah. you know, the Cosmos were like the big, again, Pele's team.
Right.
Like if you grew up with that, I mean, that's legendary.
It is.
Legends of soccer. So right. Anyway. But nobody cares. Now we just care about what's going on in the thing.
But the Timbers?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, there's more headlines here. There's that, well... Anyway, yeah. I don't know, there's a little baby that was in the UK or whatever. I have not been following that story. I don't know what that was about.
Yeah,
apparently passed away.
Took
so.
A cursory glance at it.
Yeah, I don't think that. Anyway.
Anywho.
So are there anything else that's gone on?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, NFL training camps are opening. As they're gearing up, I think the Hall of Fame game is about a week away.
Mm-hmm.
So that's exciting if you're into football. The preseason starts up here.
I hear the Dodgers are on top in the baseball?
They have, oh my gosh, they're tearing it up this year.
Yeah?
Yeah, yeah. I'm not sure, but they may have the best record in baseball right now. I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm.
We need Jay-Z for that.
Yeah.
But they are tearing it out. I mean, they are on a roll, man. And
the other big news was this
Kyrie Irving.
And
Cleveland, yeah.
And LeBron.
Yeah.
They're kind of doing, I think, the Rance Priebus Scaramucci.
Yeah.
That's what we'll call it, the Priebus Scaramucci. I think that's going on over in Cleveland.
Yeah,
right now.
The
right?
writing's on the wall for Kyrie, but he wants it too. I mean, he is. I think he's ready to step out of LeBron's shadow, and he is a marquee player. So he will land on his feet. It's gonna be kind of interesting. Will Portland throw their hat into the ring on the Kyrie? Because they traded Allen Crabb to the Portland did Blazers traded Allen Crabb to the Brooklyn Nets, which freed up a whole lot of cap space.
Mm-hmm.
So people are now wondering, wow, they have some actually funds to maneuver with. What's Portland going to do? Will they go after can you imagine?
They're going to try.
Can you imagine Kyrie Irving and Damian Lillard?
They're going to try.
And CJ McCollum. Holy cow, yeah. So it's interesting.
Yeah.
I don't know.
We'll see. We'll see if it happens.
Right.
But I just like the idea of calling it, having a Priebus Scaramucci.
It is, right. Yeah.
No! We're fine with each other. Really.
Very good. We get along.
Forget about it.
Yeah. The mooch. I'm still processing that exclusive footage.
Yes.
Holy cow.
which I'm looking at right now. Yeah, copyright claims.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, we'll see.
Yeah, we'll see.
Might have to cut it out.
Whoops.
Might have only been an exclusive for you on the stream.
Right.
We shall see.
Ooh, that's even better. It's an exclusive.
Yeah. That's what happens in fair use in comedy.
Right.
Parody, which falls under the thing, but no.
Was it the Goodfellas?
I think both.
Pesh, oh.
YouTube loves it. The algorithm. We'll see what happens. But yeah.
Wow, that's weird.
Yeah. So
over speaking voice. I thought for sure it was just music.
Nah. It's
like, wow.
Of course, the whole thing is you find all this stuff on YouTube.
So will we get dinged if we reenact it?
I don't know. That'll be next. You know. At some point, there's going to be an algorithm that. Because they caption, we are actually, if you go up and look at the posts on YouTube, you can actually pull up the captioning.
Yeah.
So it auto-captions.
Yeah.
So at some point, they'll do that.
Yeah.
I'm sure we're absolutely screwed.
Well, you know.
Captioning and all that and everything. We're
situation normal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What a Friday.
And with that.
What a country.
Right. There's a Yakov Smirnoff moment.
Yeah.
Whatever happened to Yakov Smirnoff?
Last I heard, he was in Branson. He had his own theater in Branson, Missouri.
Wow.
That is last I heard of, and I think that's still the case.
What a country.
Yeah, the Yakov Smirnoff theater.
Wow.
I think. I mean, but that's kind of...
Yeah, because he was like,
wound up.
I mean, in the 80s, you know, he was really out there and everything, and he just kind of fell off the map.
No,
you
know, no.
Yakov Smirnoff.
Branson.
Branson.
Now you're going to make me go look at it?
Branson. Hanging out in Branson. Hanging out in Dollywood.
Speaking of Smirnoff,
yes.
There's a big sale on Smirnoff. I noticed.
Speaking of Smirnoff, son. It's on sale.
No, it was on sale the other day, and I was, it's been a rough week, so.
Do they sell them in kegs?
Yeah, no, it was Yakov. You know, you can find out information about Yakov Smirnoff at yakov.com.
Ooh.
Wow.
That's cool. Yakov.com.
I'm trying to, In 1992, he bought his own theater in Branson, Missouri, where he performed until his last show on December 3rd, 2015.
Wow. So he's retired now.
Smirnoff now teaches a course titled The Business of Laughter at Missouri State University at Drury and at Drury University.
Interesting.
So there you go. But till 2015, you could go and see Yakov Smirnoff.
He's part of the faculty now.
Yeah.
I wonder if other faculty members are like Max Headroom and...
I know, right?
And Alf.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
Smirnoff became
and
an
Tootie.
American citizen on the 4th of July in 1986.
Wow, look at that.
You know damn well the quote from when he got his citizenship was...
What
the country!
Yeah. Right?
Oh, my gosh. Well, you know, we keep falling into this. At some point, we're going to... Of course, the copyright thing is a bummer, but you know, at some point we're going to like do all our favorite comedians from the 80s and the 70s and the 80s. Like, where are they now?
Right, yeah.
Man, back in the good old days.
Right.
You know.
Right. I'm still waiting for Eddie Murphy to do one more stand-up routine.
Oh.
I mean,
I'm not.
I mean, no, Delirious and Raw? Those are classics.
Yeah, but that's you can't
I'm just wondering, can he still bring it?
Yeah, no.
No?
No.
Has he been Disney-ized too long?
Yeah, I think so.
That's sad.
I know. No offense to Eddie, but I'm just saying.
Yeah, I do love me some Delirious and Raw.
I do, but, you know, he's not, I don't know. I mean, even Richard Pryor didn't even do Really didn't he didn't do stand up later when he pretty much
remember the classic Pryor on the Sunset Strip.
I know, and I actually watched that a while back recently.
Yeah, when he switched to movies.
But
and
you know,
stuff,
when he went to movies and was doing like a Superman movies and stuff like that.
Do you have a modern comic you're really into? Lewis Black.
I love that. I wish the camera would have been on you asking that question. Like you're asking, you okay? The look you had on your face when you asked that question was like the look you give your 95-year-old grandmother in the home, asking if there's some modern music or something that grandma likes.
You right? Know? Is there any crooners left?
Yeah, exactly. Is there something other than Bing Crosby that you may like?
Anyone Sinatra-esque?
Yeah.
Yes, Grandma. His name is Bublé.
Yes. Let me get my shawl and answer and answer your question.
Would you like some more Milk Toast, Grandma?
Oh my!
I'd like that. And why don't you talk to me about that whole interweb thing?
Literally, that's how you delivered that question.
Yeah.
Is there any modern? Is there anything, Doc, in your life that doesn't like end at about 1997?
I didn't mean it that way. To be fair, I was at least thinking 2002. Yeah. 2002.
You mentioned Louis Black.
Louis Black?
I'm a big fan of Louis Black.
Kevin Hart.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know about Kevin Hart.
He cracks me up.
CK.
Louis CK, yeah.
I have a hard time with Louis CK.
Yeah.
I actually don't. So I'm not the biggest Louis CK fan. There's someone else that's really good that I like.
How about Lisa Lampanelli? Works a little blue, but
no, I don't like that. They do the roasts and stuff, don't they?
Right.
Yeah. No. I watched a couple of those roasts, and I'm like, you know, I get the shawl.
On Monday, we'll be wearing shawls.
Back in my day, when we watched Lawrence Welk, no, I mean those roast things are. They're so over the top. They're not so funny.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, it's like, you know,
the Dean Martin ones were good.
I'm talking about the modern.
Yeah.
I mean, it's all sorts of
Jeff Ross.
To be honest, they're all sorts of biological waterworks for an hour, and you're like, okay, at some point, I need comedy. You know, one of my favorite.
Yeah.
Comedians, and I had the opportunity to see him in New York live, and as well as Eddie Izzard. And I don't know if you'd say he's a modern comic.
But, oh, he is, sure.
I mean, he is a modern comic, but he's been around for, I don't know, what, 20 years or so?
Something like that.
But the first time I ever saw him on HBO, I was like, this guy right here. Because all his comedy is history and culture and all this stuff. And he's just, I mean, there's so many sound, you know, do you have a flag and all the sound, all the stuff that he talks about. I mean, being into history.
Yeah.
Eddie's, you love Eddie. Yeah. I mean, he will cite history and stuff and make funny and you know, that's the kind of comedy I like.
Gotcha.
Because I think, you know, anybody can come. I mean, Richard Pryor, Red Fox.
Yeah.
I mean, these guys were blue.
Yeah.
But they were funny, though, too. And you know, and then I've seen modern comics try to do that. And it's like, not so much. You know? Gosh, I watched some comedy. You know who relatively recent routine? Dana Carvey.
I watched that on Netflix.
Yeah, did you see that one on Netflix? Dana Carvey was on Netflix.
Still pretty good.
Not bad.
Not bad.
Not bad. Not. Yeah, he's a little right wing, kind of.
Kind
of. Sort of. Not Dennis Miller right wing, but.
No, but he wasn't very sparing to Trump, though. He, you know, the whole, okay.
Yeah, no. Yeah, he did kind of some of his classic, you know, he did all his classic.
Church he even Lady and.
Garth and.
Garth, yeah.
And all of that. Yeah. So Dana Carvey.
Yeah.
Yeah. And there was somebody else I watched on there, too. There was some people that pop up. I'm tough on the comics.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's like, you know, I'm that guy, like, make me laugh, be funny, you know?
See, in those ones, there's what, Jim Gaffigan?
Oh, there is news.
Yeah.
What season are we on? Curb Your Enthusiasm.
Oh, Larry David.
Coming back, and they announced, there's some big announcements to some of the people that are going to be in it.
Nice.
Oh my gosh, I should have. I thought I didn't save it, but yes, there. Look up the new season of Curb Your Enthusiasm, yeah. And there's a lot of. I'll just look it up here since we're talking comics and sure. We're going over. It's Friday, and we need to end on a. We need
on
to
a
end
happy on, note, a jocular note.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that's coming back, season 9.
Wow. Yeah.
Curb Your Enthusiasm, season 9.
Excellent.
The guest stars, let me give you a list here. Curb Your Enthusiasm, Team Talk, season 9. You'll never... Elizabeth Banks, Bryan Cranston, Jimmy Kimmel, Ed Begley Jr., Carrie Brownstein.
Yeah.
Lauren Graham, Nick Offerman, Nassim Pedrad, and Elizabeth Perkins are all slated to guest on season 9 of Curb Your Enthusiasm. I'm... along with the then there's all the these other folks too, but those are some of the news. So Carrie Brownstein's going to be on that too. That'll be fun. So I'm assuming that we'll get some ratings.
I'm thinking that it's a very strongly followed show.
Yeah,
love me some Larry David though, man.
Yeah. Larry David and Gina Gershon together on Curb Your Enthusiasm. Oh, yeah. I love Gina Gershon.
Yeah, yeah.
And then it's like she's on Curb Your Enthusiasm and the character and the, gosh.
It's magic.
It is magic. It is, Gina Gershon is magic. And Gina Gershon and Larry David together are magic.
Mm-hmm.
That's some funny stuff. Mm-hmm. I like it. So anyway, I will work on my new comics and new music as far as, you know, like trying to find new people to listen to.
Yeah, yeah.
Justin Bieber canceled his tour. Speaking of new
music. Yeah,
Justin Bieber.
After he ran over a paparazzi guy.
Well, that happened.
Yeah.
He found God, am I hearing.
Really?
Yeah, there's some... crazy stuff going on there.
We
need
yes.
Make a mental note.
Yeah,
we're gonna need to do a little Justin Bieber news on Monday and find out what that's all about.
Bieber news. We'll leave a note for the interns to get in on this Bieber stuff.
You know it's bad. Yeah. You know it's bad when major Justin Bieber news.
Yeah,
major, and this is
major Justin news. Bieber.
Doesn't even float to the surface because look what else we got going on. The Mooch.
The Mooch. Bada bing.
The Boy Scouts.
Bada boom.
The Korea.
Yeah.
Bada bing, bada boom.
The Mooch.
Oh, brother. Anyway.
Yeah.
Have a great weekend. Watch some nice soccer on Saturday.
Yeah, yeah. Watch some soccer. Enjoy the nice weather. I guess by Sunday it's supposed to be 90 degrees again.
Ooh, again, yeah.
Yeah, but, you know, enjoy the weather. Get out there.
Yeah.
And listen, folks, when you see a lot of bad stuff on the news, when it hits the weekend, I'll scrub it off, man.
That's
just
right.
Kind of just enjoy yourself. We'll be back on Monday trying to make sense of all that's going on.
That's right. Good weather, folks.
Yeah.
Get out there. Get out to the beach. Go hit Collins Beach. Right. Clothing optional.
Or Rooster Rock or whatever it is.